Yeah, I'd like to call the February 23rd, 2016 meeting of the Reading Board of Selectmen to order. I will note that our meeting tonight is being cablecast on a delayed basis from the Great Room at Parker Middle School by RCTV, and will be cablecast at some point in the future. I'm going to go over the agenda briefly. We will begin with our customary Selectmen's liaison reports and comments, followed by public comment. Town manager's report. At 7:15, we will consider passing a gas leak resolution. We at some point will do personnel and appointments. That's not scheduled for a specific time. 7:20, we are going to acknowledge the withdrawal of a liquor license transfer for Ristorante Pavarotti. At 7:25, we will take a position on the community compact. At 7:30, we'll be conducting a joint meeting with the CPDC regarding the Reading Village 40B project. At 8:30, continue with the CPDC in a joint meeting on 40R districts. We'll be doing the volunteer appointments at 9, it's here on the agenda. And at 9:15, we'll be conducting a town of Reading financial overview. We also have approval of minutes. Any executive session tonight? No executive session. The mic situation is, I believe we have a single mic here. If we take comment from the public, I'm going to ask that this mic be used. The mics you see here are just for RCTV. We only have this one for the PA system, if you want to be heard in the room. I'll ask the board to try to speak up tonight. If there are any members from CPDC here, I invite them to come up and take the seats in the front, if they'd like, at any point in the evening. So let's begin with the Selectmen's liaison reports. Barry?
I recently attended the most recent library building committee. I don't know if anyone's had the chance to drive, when they drive down Middlesex Ave, looks like as of today, the windows were in the new addition, so it's coming along. There was a little bit of a discussion in terms of sort of the remaining construction budget. It looks like the library is probably going to use all of its contingency for construction, and maybe a little bit over, so they're just now juggling those last little bits of cutting back on some things and adding on the other. But there was, from the owner's project manager and the library building committee, a lot of confidence that it's going to get done roughly in May, when they thought it was, on budget. So, but they will use all the contingencies. So if anybody hasn't had a chance to drive by, please go down and look at it. It looks great. So.
Thank you. Kevin?
I have no reports at this time.
Okay. Let's see. John?
I attended the Birch Meadow Committee. Progress is being made there towards a report to the full Recreation Committee relative to, kind of the whole Birch Meadow project. Is the plan is to bring it forward for town meeting to look at, observe, make comment on, and that's going to be the goal. Not for a vote, but progress on the Birch Meadow project itself. I've also heard word that the RFP is due to go out on the lighting of all of Birch Meadow, so that's marching along. That's still probably about 2 weeks out from its release. There's some things that need to be done, some work with the Conservation Committee and so forth. So that's marching along, and I expect that there'll be an updated report at town meeting. So that's all I have.
Thank you, John. I'm just going to make one final exhortation. I looked at tonight's Chronicle. Did anybody look at the ballot? A lot of town meeting seats available, folks. And I'm going to give you the vacancies here. Precinct 1, there are 5 write-ins available. Precinct 2, I'm seeing 4. Plus, there's a couple of one-year and 1 2-year seat. Precinct 3, 2 write-ins available. Precinct 4, I think they have a full boat. Congratulations, they're the only one. Precinct 5 has 1 vacancy. Precinct 6 has 4 3-year seats, 1 2-year seat, and 1 1-year seat. Precinct 7 has 2 3-year seats and 1 2-year seat. And Precinct 8 has 5. Bill Brown must be very upset because he ran 10 times before. before he got elected in Precinct 7. So please, if you're seeing this before March 1st, if you know a neighbor, if you're interested yourself, consider writing yourself in or collaborating with a couple of neighbors and getting yourselves written in. We need folks at town meeting. Thanks very much. Is there any public comment on any issue not on the agenda tonight at this point? Yes, Ms. O'Neill.
Mary Ellen O'Neill, I saw that ballot too. I want to say two things. One is, on the stoppers, when the unelected moves back, the people are available very long. They happen to lose love when you move the election.
Thank you. It's we're doing a trade-off between saving money and serving the public, and maybe we need to look at that again. So, point taken. Any other comment? Okay, with that, we'll move on to the gas leak resolution issue.
I can just make a comment about the election. Dan.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Bob,
just further on the election, we're expecting very heavy turnout, which is very unusual for a local election. So if you're planning to wander in at 10 of 8, there could be a long line. By law, we will send a police officer to the end of any line, including cars out in the street, at 8 o'clock, and anyone in line will be allowed to vote. But for anyone that has paid attention to any of the primaries and caucuses in other states, there's been phenomenal turnout, even more than they expected. But just to be clear, when you walk into the field house, there are two ballots, so you need to go to two different places to get ballots, and that'll be clear when you get inside, but it's a little bit unusual. There's a local election, and then there's a primary. For the primary, you need to declare a party. For the local election, obviously, you do not. But just to be clear, one set of ballots won't fulfill your obligation for the day. There's plenty of election workers in there to help. We're going to have students from the high school to help, so it should go smoothly, but it'll be a busy day, so I appreciate it. All of you would take a little extra time and go a little early if you need to. Thanks.
That's all, Dan.
Hey, thank you very much. You want to lead the discussion on gas leak?
Sure. Last fall, two different House bills were filed and not acted on by the legislature. The Climate Advisory Committee came in front of this board and asked for you to support both of them. Our three legislators have given you their opinions. Senator Lewis is a co-sponsor of both bills, and I'll read them. House 2870, an act relative to protecting consumers of gas and electricity for paying for leaked and unaccounted for gas. House Bill 2871, an act relative to gas leak repairs during road projects. Senator Dwyer has said he's very aware of the issue and supportive of the concept. And Senator Jones has distinguished the two bills, saying that the one for gas leak repairs, 2871, is good legislation. 2870 is not quite as good. He's not sure how effective it'll be if it's implemented, although he does not oppose it. This board obviously just has, if you will, a ceremonial role, as many other communities have done, in sending their voice to the legislature supporting it. And as this board discussed last fall, normally the selectmen don't poke their nose into Beacon Hill's business, if you will. But in this case, there's actually a significant community issue where there are natural gas leaks and natural gas pipelines in town that should be fixed. And this legislation may help the gas company take some more responsibility and fix them. So that's pretty much a wrap-up of where we are. And I have a motion in front of you that lists both bills.
Mr. Secretary, would you like to offer the motion?
Move that the board support House Bill 2870, an act relative to protecting consumers of gas and electricity from paying for leaked and unaccounted for gas. House Bill 2871, an act relative to gas leak repairs during road projects. And that the board, through its designee, notify the elected Reading delegation in the House and Senate.
We have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I think it's important to point out that when I first heard about this, I didn't think it was a good idea for us to poke our nose in the legislative activities that should be handled by our elected representatives on Beacon Hill. But as we had a chance to look deeper into this issue that was brought up to us by the advisory board, you know, it's pretty clear. I think there's, you know, scores of leaks in Reading that, you know, are directly affected. It directly affects their bills. And, you know, and I think it is our job, anytime it affects Reading citizens, to step up and have our voice heard. So I'm going to endorse, personally going to endorse that we send this resolution on both bills.
Yeah, I think I followed a similar path to John and Representative Jones. I like the 2871 endorsement. Now, I wasn't quite sure if the 2870 was tightly enough drafted, but I'm going to support this. Reading's interest. Barry?
Yeah, I mean, in general, I agree. Our bandwidth is pretty stretched as it is just in standalone town business. But when there's a clear danger to public health, and also pocketbooks, I think we as an elected board have a responsibility to weigh in on behalf of the citizens. And if that even just pushes or nudges this type of legislation along a little bit, and we're certainly not doing their jobs, but if we lend our voices to it, it's just another shoulder to the wheel. So I'm going to vote for it.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the resolution?
No.
The motion carries 4-0. Okay. The next item on the agenda is the withdrawal of the liquor license transfer for Ristorante Pavarotti. Is the applicant here or Bob?
I can explain that.
That's fine.
In front of the board at a previous meeting was a request to transfer a liquor license as the business was being sold. The sale has fallen through, but the application is still in front of the ABCC. We notified the ABCC, please don't approve it now because you know, we're going to withdraw that request. But formally, the board is the only one that can withdraw that request. You saw in your packets over the weekend a letter from both the buyer and the seller agreeing that the deal is off. So it's really as simple as that.
Yep. Okay. So it's a housekeeping situation.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Is there a motion, please?
Move that the Board of Selectmen acknowledge the withdrawal of the liquor license transfer from Ristorante Pavarotti, Inc., DBA, Ristorante Pavarotti, 601 Main Street, to Rocco's Enterprises, LLC.
Second?
Second.
Okay. Discussion? All in favor? Motion carries 4-0. Okay, on to the community compact. Bob, could you go over the background of this, please?
Certainly. We have our planning staff to the left here. Some of the selectmen and some staff have looked at this for a couple of months. I know at the MMA, Selectman Berman was in having some discussions when Secretary Ash was out visiting Reading. Actually, on two occasions, he spoke very favorably of it. We've done the research. We're in a position to agree that we should approve the list of best practices that have been shown to you, if you agree, and specifically to appoint the chair as the signatory authority for this. Since the program was launched, there actually has already been grant funding available, which is really fast for a program to be funded, especially in a difficult time. The first funding had a cutoff of late January for technology. It wouldn't have done us any good. We already had the technology we needed. But you never know for future situations. Being one of the compact communities certainly could be to our advantage, and there's no detriment to it. And both Julie and Jean are here if you have any questions.
Very good. Okay. Can we make a motion over there? Compact
make a motion?
Yeah.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the list of best practices submitted as part of the application package for the community compact, and further that the chair is designated as a compact signatory for such application.
Okay, is that second?
Second.
Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? 4-0, the motion carries. Okay.
If I might suggest you go on to 5E, just because we're a little early for the public.
Yeah, excellent suggestion.
Yep. That's a good idea.
Hey, Mr. Chair of the Volunteer Appointments Subcommittee, would you like to give a brief report on our candidates?
I should give a brief report. Both myself and Selectman Halsey are appointed to be the Volunteer Appointments Subcommittee, and we had a meeting last week where we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 appointees in total. We had some interviews, had some folks come in. This is something that we go through in case anyone in the audience is actually interested in volunteering as well. It's always on the website, what's available, what the different boards and committees are that you can be appointed to. And it's a simple procedure. Really, you come down, have an interview with us after you've selected what it is you'd like to, what board or committee you'd like to serve on, submit the paperwork to the town hall, come down, have a meeting with us like these folks did last week. And if there are no objections, you know, obviously we welcome volunteers and happy to put them on the various boards and committees. The more that it, you know, meets the kind of your profession or something, a passion that you're interested in, and those two meet up, that's really even better. And, you know, we've been lucky in town to have a really good base of volunteers that meet just that criteria. So in this case, we had a few of them, and I was impressed with a couple of them. Let Mr. Halsey speak in as well. I'd like to.
Yeah, well, you know, as Kevin points out, volunteerism is so important, and we've had a lot of vacancies, and happily we've had a lot of people recently express an interest, and I think it's a great trend, actually. And as we've had interviews over time, we did sometimes the position somebody wanted wasn't available, so they were waiting for an opportunity to present itself. So a couple of these you're going to hear tonight are people who have been patiently waiting to join a certain committee. Others have expressed recent interest, and we had a great round of interviews, and we're very happy to be presenting a group of people for approval to the full board so that we can swear them in and get them working. And we'll give them big raises if they show up for the first meeting.
You bet. We can pay them overtime. Time and a half.
Kevin, if I might.
Sure.
It's interesting, the volunteers, I've been involved in the volunteers for almost 20 years now, and in the last two or three years, there's actually been a pretty significant change that the board is now seeing a fairly substantial amount of volunteers that have only just moved to Reading. Mm-hmm. It used to be people that had been in Reading for 10, 20, 30, 35 years. Now it's people within their first or second year of Reading, so I think that's really interesting and very encouraging also.
Yeah, I agree, and thanks to you gentlemen for all the hard work you've been doing on the subcommittee. I think it's
welcome.
It's borne some very good fruit here. Would you like to make the motion?
I shall.
Okay.
Move that the Board of Selectmen accept the recommendations of the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee as follows. Harry Curtis for a term on the Conservation Commission ending June 30th, 2018. Amy Sicatani for a term on the Conservation Commission ending June 30th, 2018. Nick Pernice for an associate position in the Zoning Board of Appeals through June 30th, 2017. Robert Beckman for an associate position on the Falls Street Fair through June 30th, 2017. Jeff Everson for an associate position on the Climate Advisory Committee through June 30th, 2016. Jack Williams for a term on the Historical Commission through June 30th, 2016.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Discussion?
Are any of those folks here? Just curious.
Yes.
I believe Amy's here.
Too. Amy's here.
I saw her in the audience. Yeah.
Thank you for putting your candidacy forward. Thank you very much. Okay. Call for the vote. All in favor? Motion carries 4-0. Let's go on to minutes. We have a few minutes left. We have January 12th, 2016.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of January 12th, 2016 as amended.
Is that a second?
Second?
Second.
Okay. Discussion? Any comments? Okay. All in favor? Motion carries 4-0. And January 20th.
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes for January 20th, 2016 as amended.
Second.
Second.
Okay. Discussion? Amendments? All in favor? That motion carries 4-0. We can do the executive session minutes providing there's no amendments in open session. Is there a motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the executive session minutes for January 26th, 2016 as written.
And as seconded by?
Second.
By Mr. Berman. And I'll call for a roll call vote. Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Halsey?
Yes.
Myself, yes. That carries 4-0.
We take a 2-minute break and let them set up.
Yeah, sure. We'll take 2 or 3 minutes, and if the proponent of the 40B would like to do some setting up, feel free to do that at this point. call us back into session. I've been asked by a few folks through the proponent here to use the mic because you're having a hard time hearing us up here. So I'm going to ask everybody who speaks to please use this mic. And as I said, these mics up front will pick it up for our CTV, but they're not for the PA system. Would the CPDC like to call itself to order at this point?
Sure, yeah. Call this meeting of the Community Planning and Development Commission to order.
Okay, thank you. And we are now entering the 7:30 p.m. Agenda item, the joint meeting with CPDC regarding Reading Village 40B project. I'd like to give a little background on 40B for the benefit of the folks listening and present tonight. To qualify for Chapter 40B, a development proposal must first be approved under a state or federal housing program. There are requirements on a percent of units that must be made affordable. Towns are allowed to establish a local preference for residents. Currently, up to 70% of the units can be for local preference. Developers must also agree to restrict their profit to a maximum of 20% for in-sale developments and 10% per year for rental developments, unless indicated otherwise in the subsidy program or the comprehensive permit. After a project has been determined to be eligible, the developer can submit an application for a comprehensive permit to the Zoning Board of Appeals. The ZBA is empowered to grant all local approvals necessary for the project after consulting with other relevant boards, such as the Planning Board and the Board of Health. That's the purpose of tonight's meeting, and there will be others too. This results in a more streamlined review process at the Zoning Board, although it typically involves a number of hearing sessions. State regulations such as the Wetlands Protection Act, Title V, and all building codes remain fully in effect under the comprehensive permit. Therefore, the Local Conservation Commission will review the project regarding compliance with the state's Wetlands Protection Act. In addition to the streamlined process, the Zoning Board of Appeals is authorized to apply more flexible standards than strict local zoning bylaw requirements. For example, a local zoning code may require 2 acres of land for each house, or prohibit multifamily housing entirely. Under Chapter 40B, the Zoning Board of Appeals can approve a project with greater density, thereby making it financially feasible to develop affordable housing. ZBAs can also require projects to have a greater number of affordable units. And regarding the local review process, a developer acting under a Chapter 40B submits a single application to the ZBA. The Zoning Board notifies the applicable local boards and requests their recommendations. Within 30 days of the receipt of the application, the Zoning Board begins a public hearing, which has happened. This typically continues for several months while concerns are explored and addressed. The Zoning Board must address a decision within 40 days after ending the public hearing. The Zoning Board may approve the application as submitted. It can approve the project with conditions or changes, or it can deny the application altogether. If the board denies the application or opposes, quote, uneconomic, unquote, conditions, the developer may appeal the decision to the Housing Appeals Committee. The developer must still obtain various permits required by state statutes, such as wetlands protection, state highway access permits, and local building permit. Could I invite the proponent to come up and introduce himself and members of his team? And I'm going to join the audience here. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the Selectmen, CPDC, town staff, members of the public that are here tonight, and those watching on TV. I'm Matthew Zucker from MKM Reading, the developer of the project. We have other my partner, Matthew Roman and Ken Chase are here tonight. We have our architects from Q3 Associates. They'll all speak and introduce themselves. We're here tonight to reintroduce ourselves and Reading Village, a proposed 77-unit, transit-oriented 40B development on a blighted site across from the Reading commuter rail. As you know, we had our first Zoning Board of Appeals public hearing, comprehensive permit public hearing, on February 4th, and our next hearing is scheduled for March 17th. Recently, on February 18th, we had another design review team meeting with many of the town departments and continued discussions on questions and comments each of the town departments had. Most importantly, Fire Chief Burns was there, and we discussed with him how the project meets all fire codes, and we reiterated our commitment to working with the fire department to further enhance the safety of the building. I wasn't at that meeting, I was away, but my partner Ken Chase was there, and he could get into greater detail on the DRT meeting. The state and municipalities all across the state are recognizing that the best places to locate high-density housing are, one, downtown locations, and two, locations near public transportation. Reading Village meets both of these goals. It is downtown, and it is across from the train station. Idea of the project site. Transit-oriented developments like this one encourage people to live downtown, to work downtown, and to shop downtown. To thrive, downtown Reading needs a mix of businesses and people to shop at those businesses regularly. Reading Village brings much-needed people downtown and encourages people to shop at many of the local businesses. And it will meet the goals and objectives of the 2005 Reading Master Plan, the 2007 Downtown Reading Market Assessments, and the recent December 2015 draft Town of Reading Economic Development Action Plan. We've put a lot of design time and effort into the design and development of the project. Let me show you current. That's the existing site right there, looking down towards the train station and looking up Prescott Street, and then looking across at the Certainly Wood building on Lincoln Street. As we get into further detail, it's important to note that 70% of the units at Reading Village are one-bedroom units. It's designed to attract young professionals who use Uber, Zip cars, and rely on public transportation, and will walk to downtown businesses to spend money. Earlier this month, we sent out letters to all our direct abutters, and we are starting to set up meetings individually with them next week to discuss specific comments they have. As we've continually stated, this is a process. We look forward to listening to all your comments, questions, and concerns, and working with all of you as we move through what we hope to be a collaborative effort. I have Peter Bartash tonight from Cube 3 Architects. We'll discuss the design approach and architecture of the building. Our traffic engineer, Jeffrey Dirk from Vanessa Associates, couldn't attend tonight, but Vanessa Associates has prepared a detailed traffic impact analysis, and it's concluded that the project can be accommodated within the confines of the existing transportation infrastructure in a safe and efficient manner. Our architect, our traffic engineer, our civil engineer, and the whole development team will continue to work closely with the town, the peer review consultants, and all the boards as we move through the process. Reading Village is a soundly designed, economically viable, transit-oriented 40B development on a lighted site, and it will help advance the growth of the town as a whole, and specifically downtown Reading. With that said, I'll pass it off to Ken Chase to discuss the DRT meeting, and more specifically some of the comments that the fire chief has had brought to date, and then we will pass it off to Peter Bartash from Q3 to discuss the architecture, and then we will be here for questions and comments.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I think Matt already introduced us, but I'm Ken Chase, for those of you I haven't met individually. We are looking forward to working with you all on this, and I want to mention that as we look at this and go through this presentation tonight, we want you to know that this is the beginning of a process, not the end. So we don't have all the answers yet, but we have a lot of the form and shape of what we believe will be a transit-oriented project that will really add value here. One of the biggest questions that was raised as we looked at this site, and these pictures are important to look at as we're talking about this, some of the safety issues that were raised were related to the height of the building, access around the building, okay, and its proximity to other structures, so other homes around this site. So right now, as you look at the two buildings, Certainly Wood, and you said moving and storage, those are the Certainly Wood building is actually on the property line. The Doucette moving and storage building is very close. And in terms of what I would call a standard for modern fire safety and suppression, I think it's safe to say that no one would disagree with me that it's not up to standard. In terms of the buildings that we've proposed, they do meet the state building code and the state fire code. So international building code, which is applied locally here and amended, our building as proposed meets, and the a national fire code, NFPA, that is put out our building also. And so when we look at things like the height of the building, which was one of the issues, the height of this building is actually under what the state allows for a building of this type. So there are a lot of things in the building code, without getting into a ton of detail. You know, there are pages that say you can't have a building more than 40 feet. And then there are pages that say you can't have a building more than 70 feet. And then there's another section that says you can't have a building more than 150 feet. And the reason is, it depends on what that building is used for. So in the case of what we have here for the occupancy type we have, which is residential, the use, which is for apartments, the height meets the building code. In terms of fire safety, one of the biggest questions that was raised was access. Well, you know, how can we get a fire truck all the way around the building? Well, the state doesn't require us to create access all the way around the building. What they do require us to do is to get a fire truck within 150 feet of any part of the building. And we can very easily do that with two access points, one on Prescott and one on Lincoln. So I think we very clearly can address that. And finally, in terms of proximity to other structures, the building that we're proposing, despite the buildings that are on the site now, will have a 1 hour fire rating on the outside of the building. So in addition to having a full a wet sprinkler system in the building itself, a dry sprinkler system down below for the parking garage, and all kinds of fire suppression in the building, fire extinguishers in the apartments, fire extinguishers in the hallways, pull boxes for fire, call boxes in the elevator, every modern fire safety amenity you can imagine is in the building already. In addition to that, the outside of the building is protected with a 1 hour fire rating everywhere. So, and that also meets all the state codes. So, we didn't want to get into a lot of detail about this at this point, but what we wanted to make sure everyone knew is that the state does a very good job of deciding what safety means for different types of use and occupancy, and our buildings, as proposed, meet those requirements. So, with that, I'm going to turn it over to Peter from Q3.
Thank you, Ken, and thank you, everyone, for your time tonight. I know some of you have seen this presentation as part of our initial presentation to the Zoning Board, and for the purposes of people who haven't seen it, I'm going to walk through briefly how the plans are laid out, how we're arranging the parking under the building, the way the building above stacks up with our units, corridors, egress, and then we'll talk a little bit about the design from the exterior. So what we're looking at here is, let me get back one step here. So we're looking at the project site as Matt and Ken had talked about. Here we go. We have Lincoln Street, we have Prescott Street, here's the MBTA station, and then here is the continuation of downtown along Haven Street. And so a few things that we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about access points for vehicles, both from Prescott and Lincoln. We're going to talk about primary residential entry points. We're going to talk about a landscaped elevated courtyard that sits at the rear of the site. And we're going to speak a little bit more about how the project design is designed to help start to break down the massing and scale of the building as a whole. So when we get a little closer into the plan here, again, we have Prescott Street and we have Lincoln Street. Our primary vehicle access point is a two-way enter and exit from Prescott Street that enters the lower left-hand portion of the plan here. I don't know if you guys can see the pointer, but we enter into the garage, and we have a two-way circulation loop within the garage itself, and you can see all of our parking off of that circulation loop. We have a one-way connection back to the other portion of the project, which is labeled as Building B here, and that one-way exits back out onto Lincoln Street. Within the garage, we're doing a few things. We have our primary residential entry here at the corner facing Prescott Street. That's for pedestrian access. We have our mail function set up on the outside of the building for mail and deliveries to the building itself. We have a vestibule condition here that serves as a buffer from the exterior to the interior and gets you to the elevator core, as well as one of the three residential stairs. We have our second residential stair in this location and our third over at the end of Building B, and you'll see how that ties into the upper plan in a second. And we also have our key service, water and fire, trash room, and main electrical rooms within the parking area here. And for the purposes of referring to this as we move through the presentation, this entire level of this plan is referred to as the podium. It's the parking podium. It's a non-combustible construction. It's technically classified as an S2 storage use. And what that means is that you're allowed to provide the parking here as a storage use beneath the residential building when you look at the way it's classified by code, as Kent had mentioned. Some other important things to notice, you do have the dashed line here that extends along the rear property line. And the rear property line sits here, you can see. If we step off of that by about 7 or 8 feet, you have the edge of the podium and the edge of the building above at this face here and this face here. And it's important to note that the parking does overlap beyond that edge and does come up close to the edge of the property line, where we will be proposing some screening and some measures to kind of control glare. We have to, by code, control glare for all of the any headlights or anything that happens along that edge. But you'll also see that the dashed line jogs. And what that does is this is the space above that's being used for an outdoor courtyard space at the first residential level. And so there's only direct exposure from the building against the rear property line at this location and at this location. And I'm speaking specifically about Building A. And I do recognize that Building B does also present a face to the abutters who sit in this area of the plan, which isn't currently shown. As you can see, the property line does jog as we get toward Building B and does create a little bit more of an area for buffering and screening facing back toward the neighborhood. And one of the other things that I'd like to note as well is the fact that we have left space in this corner of the plan, which would be the proposed location for a site transformer, which would be fully screened and coordinated with the utility company to provide access as they need from Prescott Street. And and by setting this side of the plan away from the property line, what we're doing is really allowing for that access that Ken was beginning to talk about, you know, in order to really start to set ourselves up to allow for that access around the building here. So I'm going to keep moving, move on to the upper floor plan. One of the things that it's obviously a little hard to see, but we're presenting roughly 170 feet of frontage along Prescott Street. And we're presenting close to, I believe, 90 feet of frontage along Lincoln Street here. At the upper floor plan, these two buildings are connected by a pedestrian bridge that does extend from this corner of the plan to the other corner of Building B here. This is a standard double-loaded corridor configuration, it's called. And what that essentially means is that we've got our stairs at either end. There's a corridor that runs to the center of the building that also accesses your elevator and this other kind of secondary stair, and off of that corridor you have all of your residential units to either side, which give them exposure to the exterior and get you to natural light. At this first level of residential, this is that courtyard I had been speaking about, and within that courtyard space, which is elevated, it's private, it's for residents, it'll be landscaped, and by that I mean it'll have some low plantings, it'll have some grass pavers and some other hardscape, as well as some furniture and other sort of provisions to allow people to use this as kind of a quiet outdoor space and to provide them with an amenity for the project. And one of the other things that I'd like to know, as it was something that's been heavily discussed by our team and also at the DRT meeting, is the fact that this corner of the plan, which is just designated right here, the main knuckle of Building A, is an internal trash chute. And so I bring that as a point of emphasis, as much as trash is not the most exciting thing from an architect standpoint, because what we're proposing is that this trash chute connects through all residential floors of the building, and it dumps into a trash room in the basement of the building, which has a compactor, so all of the trash is managed internal to the project. It's not as if we have dumpsters that are set outside of the building or that are going to allow kind of trash to be exposed, other than for the purpose of getting it from the dumpster to the trucks as it's picked up. And as we've talked about, there's a lot more coordination to do with how that trash is going to be served and managed. But I just wanted to bring that up as a point of emphasis, because it is something that we're actively thinking about and planning for. When you move to a typical upper level plan, you'll see that obviously the courtyard drops away, and now you just have the true footprint of the building that rises up to the full four floors. I'm going to keep going here. So this is another typical plan. Bear with me for 1 second. Yep, I think the battery might have gone out, but I'll just flip from here, that's fine. And so here we're looking at the roof plan. And so what you'll note is that it can. So I'm going to take a step back here and talk about the roof plan before we get too far ahead. So there's a lot of technical information here about the roof slopes that we have. We have attempted to minimize the overall slope of the roofs to the lowest extent possible based on the limitations of the construction type and the material, being asphalt, architectural grade shingles. And what we're doing is twofold. One, we're doing that in order to help lower the perceived height of the building. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second when we look at the section. But we're also proposing that the center of this roof be carved out to serve as an area well to house the rooftop mechanical equipment that serves all the residential units. That gets this equipment up and away from the surrounding neighbors. It gets it out of the line of sight, and it keeps a lot of the noise and other things that are generated by this equipment, mainly noise, from being perceptible from the ground level and from the surrounding properties. And so the section is fairly important for helping understand how the building height works. So here we have Prescott Street on the right-hand side of the page. Here we have the parking podium that extends, as we saw, back to the property line in the rear, which is roughly in this location. This is that outdoor landscaped courtyard space that faces toward the rear of the project. And then you see we have our residential units on either side of a corridor that rises up the four floors of the building. So one of the design moves that we've made as an attempt to help lower the perceived height of the building from the street and from the from just general area surrounding is to actually nestle the roof down onto the upper floor of the building. And so all of our inhabitable space at the upper floor is existing within these dormers that are popped out. And so this line right here at the top of the third floor is actually where it looks like the roof is set when you're standing on the ground and looking up at the project. And so from that point, the roof slopes back and meets a common ridge point here in the center of the plan. And at moments where we need to create that headroom and that space within the units, you do have this popped out dormer condition, which is what we're looking at in this section right here. Looking at the elevation and talking a little bit about the architectural design intent, Matt and Ken have been great in pushing us to really consider doing something a little bit more than the norm. They recognize this is close to the train depot. They recognize that this is an opportunity to connect with a reference to that sort of language and that sort of style. And so we've taken a cue from that and said, how can we go ahead and really build on that idea and create something that's really impactful and memorable from an architectural design standpoint? And so there are a couple elements here that I think are important to note. These deep overhanging roofs, both at the ground level, which help to start break up the building vertically and provide kind of a true pedestrian edge that is defined. The overhanging eaves up top will provide extended shadows on the face of the building, which will help lower the perceived scale of these facades, and also give us the opportunity to integrate these architectural brackets, which don't seem like a big deal, but on a project of this type are actually very significant. They're a very integral feature of that image and that look that adds that character and that sort of richness that help improve the overall design aesthetic. What's a little difficult to see just based on the likeness of this image right now in the room here is the fact that we do have these inset bays that are a slightly different tone and a different material and will add shadow and texture across the facade as you move along Prescott Street and along this pedestrian or vehicle edge that we're creating. At the podium level, where the garage faces the street, we are proposing, rather than leaving the parking exposed to the edge, we want to be very conscious of what your experience is like as a pedestrian moving along the building. And so you can see that these openings between the structure of that podium are infilled with the materials from the building above that are carried down. They're infilled with glass. They're infilled in a way that makes this feel like a cohesive experience that's active, that's lively, that's engaging. And at moments where we're creating entry or focus, we're breaking the overall massing of the building and creating these slots and these recesses that add shadow, that add depth, that make this look not only like it's built up over time, but also tie in with the overall theme that we've talked about, which is to really kind of create this overall building image that starts to break itself down and present a truly public and articulated edge to the street. And so I
Also want to talk quickly, this is the, these are the dormers that we were talking about before that are exposed to the units on the inside and that give us the headroom that we need. But these roofs are sloped, and one thing that's tough to look at when you look at elevations like this is to understand that this ridge line that you're seeing up here is 30 feet back from the face of the building. And so you have to get a fairly measurable distance away from the building in order to actually see the full extent of that height. But in reality, based on the way that the neighborhood is laid out, the streets exist around the project, it'll be very difficult to ever really fully perceive this elevation from top to bottom the way that it's represented here. And so when we turn the corner on the side of the building, this is not a project with one front door or one face. And so it's not as if you can dress up one side of it and let everyone else just kind of deal with whatever they get. We really need to be conscious and consistent as we carry the language around the building. And so here we're looking at a typical side elevation that shows how those extended eaves wrap around the corner of the building. Shows how the language of the roof also turns the corner, as do all of the materials and rhythm and window articulation that we're talking about from the other facade. So we're really treating this on all four faces, which is, it may not seem like something you wouldn't do, but is fairly uncommon, and is a direct result of Matt and Ken and Matt really pushing us to be considerate as we're moving around the project. And so the last thing we have here, these are some shadow study examples that we were asked to put together. And what we're really talking about is the nature of the potential impact on access to light and open air from the surrounding neighborhood. And so as you can see, based on the way the shadows are cast, the lower side of the screen here is the kind of east to west and south portion that's facing up toward the project. We have Prescott Street again, we have Lincoln Street here. And this is the existing shadow, just to note, this is the existing shadow from the existing building at a different time of year than is represented by this slide. So I recognize that there is a difference in where that edge is shown versus where we're saying this will cast a shadow on the absolute longest shadow day of the year. But there, I just wanted you to recognize that there's a reason for that case. And so here, again, we're talking about December 21st. We're looking at 10 o'clock in the morning when the shadows are, it's one of the two times during the day where the shadows are longest. And you can see that the shadow does fall across Prescott Street and impacts this open parking lot across the street. And the shadows from Building B fall on Lincoln Street, but don't end up reaching the actual depot itself. As we move forward, throughout the day, you're looking at 12 p.m. on December 21st. And you can see that these shadows have shortened up to just fall on the other side of Prescott Street. And we have the shadow that falls on Lincoln Street starting to migrate further to the east. And then at the end of the day, just before the sun starts to go down, you can see that these shadows from both buildings fall across the intersection of Prescott and Lincoln and across the tracks. So similarly, June 21st, when the sun angle is most steep, looking back at the project, you can see that the actual shadow is almost barely perceptible where it falls on Prescott Street. And actually the same can be said here for the shadow that falls from Building B. It doesn't even impact Lincoln Street. And moving through in the middle of the day at noon, again, this red line is on the sidewalk, but we're actually not even impacting Prescott Street here. And then as you move forward and later on in the day, you can see that there's a slight shadow that falls onto our courtyard, but falls short of falling past the property line. And then our shadow here that ends up on Lincoln Street. And so lastly, we look at March and September, which are the kind of other points that we're asked to consider to really give a full picture of the shadow analysis. And now you can see that this is about the same time as the shadow that's in the aerial photo that we started with. And our shadow is extending past the edge of that existing line by roughly 5 feet, because even though this new proposed project is slightly taller than the existing building that's there, because of the roof design and because of the way we've nestled the roof into the building itself, we're actually only ending up with a height that's roughly 5 or 6 feet taller than what's there. And so you can see as the shadows move around, we're getting the similar impacts. So that's a brief overview of the architecture.
That concludes our brief presentation for tonight. We've heard a lot of questions and comments so far. Big ones, height, density, parking ratio, more specific ones, snow removal, trash removal, utilities, and we have a whole list of questions that we're working through. Our next zoning board public hearing is March 17th. We expect to have a lot of those answers that have been asked by audience and from staff at that hearing. I'm more than happy to answer any questions, comments tonight that we can, but we look forward to going through the process at our next meeting in March.
Thank you very much. We'd like to conduct this, I'm going to first have a discussion between the boards, which is the primary intent, but I'm sure there's a fair amount of public interest here. If there's people that do want to make comments on the record, we'll reserve some time for public comment at the end. So let's take a minute to retake our places here. Representatives from the fire department here tonight? I see anybody? I have a note from Chief Burns dated May 15, 2015. It was in our packet this evening. Concerned about, maybe I'll just have you review this. He had some concerns about State Building Code 780 CMR 8th edition regarding the automatic sprinkler system, open parking garage beneath. Could you tell me if you have redesigned and addressed these concerns in this memorandum? You could be specific. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you. Yes, actually, as part of our meeting with the DRT, we did review each of these items in detail. I believe we submitted an extensive memo that went through and cataloged the code path to compliance for every one of the items the chief had iterated. The list was fairly extensive, so I can talk about them now in detail, or?
Yes, if you would.
Sure. So the automatic sprinkler increase, I think we'll start with that because it ties in with several of the concerns that the fire chief had. Specifically, his issues were related to building area as a function of allowable area on the proposed site, and also overall building height. And so from the code standpoint, I had mentioned that we were talking about a podium level at the ground and then the residential building above. From a code standpoint, those are two separate buildings. And the type of construction we're talking about here is referred to as type 5A. And what that means is you're placing a wood-framed building, which is completely its own thing, on top of a non-combustible type 1A or 1B building below, which is that podium level. And so when you're looking at overall height as a function of the way that building steps up, you're doing two things. One, you're considering the overall height of the structure that's taken from the top of the podium and not from grade for the purposes of determining allowable height. And then you're looking at the fire protection methods within the building, so the NFPA 13 sprinkler system, all of the two-way communications, the fire extinguishers that are installed throughout. There's a whole list of requirements that you have to comply with. And by doing that system, you're permitted an increase of 200% on top of your allowable floor area per floor. But you're also permitted an increase in overall height by story. So with those increases, you're technically allowed to go up to five levels of wood framing over that podium. This project is proposing four. Mm-hmm. But the other requirement to be aware of is the fact that in Massachusetts, the high-rise limitation is set at 70 feet. Once a building crosses that threshold, it's subject to an entirely new set of criteria for what stairwells are treated, the way that you deal with a whole host of systems within the building. And for the purposes of this project, the project height actually falls beneath that criteria. So we are subject to the requirements of type 5A and not of high-rise construction. And the reason I make that point is because the NFPA 13 system is actually not required as a base. A 13R system is required as a base by 527 CMR, but we've made that extra step to put in the full NFPA 13 system, which provides the fire department with standpipes, it provides them with enhanced communication features. It provides them with additional protective measures within the project to help enhance the overall life safety of the building as a whole. Specifically related to fire rating, which I know Ken talked about, the Type 5A construction requires a half-hour fire rating at all of its interior bearing walls, and it doesn't require any specific rating for the exterior walls of the project.
Now it's an hour. Yeah.
Right, and now it's an hour because of the proximity to the property lines and because of the way that we're composing the actual wall assembly. These guys are proposing that we'll be using fiber cement materials on the exterior, and those materials are non-combustible. So what that's doing is it's actually combined with the overall construction of the wall type, giving you a one-hour rating both inside and out. And as a function of meeting the sound and impact requirements for the floor and wall ceiling assemblies in the project, we're actually exceeding the code minimums for the fire rating of those members and providing 1 hour fire rating for all walls and floors throughout the project. So it's going above and beyond those requirements. I'm going to look at the, I want to see. So this open parking garage, question was related to the allowable, its allowableness based on building height.
Right.
And so we've talked about that, proximity to existing properties. So the building code talks about two things. It talks about the relationship between the building and its own property boundary, and it also talks about the relationship between the building and existing structures. And so in this case, the building code outlines an entire chart that tells you in certain distance ranges you're permitted to have a certain amount of allowable openings that are unprotected on any given wall. And so we've done two things. One, we've vetted the exterior design related to those requirements and made sure that we're not providing more unprotected glazing on any surface than we're allowed by the code. But we're also meeting or exceeding the fire rating requirements, as I suggested, by the 1 hour rating of those exterior walls. If you were to look at that table, which I believe is table 602 in the code, it talks specifically about the distance to property lines and the fire ratings that you're required to have. And for this type of construction, the 1 hour, here we go. Table 602. So for this, in this case, for a fire separation distance of 0 to less than 3 feet, at non-bearing exterior walls, we're required a rating of 1 hour. And in the case of the construction of this building, the building will most likely be framed from tenant separation wall to tenant separation wall, which means that almost none of the exterior walls will be bearing. And in the case that we need an exterior wall to be bearing, the structure will be designed so that that wall is not a wall that is near to the property line based on this table. So we also offer full draft stopping and fire blocking protection. All of these stairwells that run through the project are a 2 hour rating. And the reason for that is because between the two buildings, the lower podium, the residential building, you're required to have a fire separation that meets the rating of the lower occupancy type, so the podium, so that has to be a 2 hour rating. And all of the stairwells are technically a penetration through that rating. This is kind of a crash course in how to do type 5A construction. All of the stairwells need to be 2 hour rated as well. So they're 2 hour rated connecting through up through the structure. The trash chute is 2 hour rated, it's self-enclosed. The elevator shaft is a CMU masonry construction that runs up through the project and is independent of the wood frame. It is also 2 hour rated. So is there more detail you'd like?
No, thank you for that answer.
Sure.
Thank you very much. Okay, I'd like to open it now to questions either from staff, from Board of Selectmen, or CPDC, so feel free. I just ask you to use the mic. Yes, Mr. Tuttle.
Thank you. I'll try not to pull everything off here. I was at the first Zoning Board of Appeals meeting, so this is not the first view I've had of it. But what you've been describing is an entirely rental property, but you have not described anything about the rental management or local superintendent or custodian within the existing structure. Is there a plan for how it could be operated?
Let me just put it down the front there. Somebody like to?
At this point, we're, you know, early in the permitting process. The building will be professionally managed by a management company that works in multifamily residential apartment buildings in Massachusetts. So, but, you know, as we get further along the process, we're more than happy to get into greater detail about that specifically. As we get further along in the process, we're more than happy to discuss the rental management professional company that we'll be using. It's just early in the process, and we're still working through a couple of options.
Thank you. Other questions?
Yes.
I guess I have a lot of questions or comments, so I'll just try to pick some of these. One of the things that stands out, though, is that you continually call this a blighted site, and that's true. But as somebody mentioned at ZBA, it's not a blighted neighborhood. And so that blanket statement that anything is better than what's there, anything is better than what's there, really doesn't apply. When I look at this plan, I like this building. And if we were talking Somerville or Cambridge or Malden, this is great. But it's really not contextual. It doesn't address the context at all. It's an extrusion of the property lines, maximizing the number of units. And maybe that's the exercise it was intended to be, and that's fine. But it doesn't address those residential edges on three sides. Maybe the height's warranted on two of the sides. The site really only has two sections that are tall, maybe 30% of the site, you know, plan-wise. The roof, this idea that it references the depot building, that's probably okay, but the fact that it doesn't step back, that it sort of projects forward, really just increases the mass of this tower. And the bigger concern really is that you're at zero lot line on the front, and this roof projects out and slopes, and it's north-facing, and you're gonna get snow and ice falling down that, you know, true pedestrian edge you keep talking about. The pedestrian edge, of course, whether you put windows in front of it or not, is still looking into a parking garage. So I'm either walking past it looking at cars, or if you put spandrel glass in, I'm looking at myself, and neither is really that interesting to me. I'm just wondering if maybe there's something better that can be done at that edge, whether the units could actually come down, or whether you could have stoops there that start to mimic what's happening up the street. Really, it's building massing to me, and even in urban developments, the massing usually addresses the context. So in Manhattan, when you've got high rise on one side of a super block and brownstones on the other side, those developments will typically step down. And I'm just wondering if you step the back of this building down towards the residential edges that are behind it, not only do you address the context and take down some of that mass, but you have opportunity for private balcony spaces, which are only going to increase the value of those rental units. The only outdoor space you have is this elevated courtyard. So that doesn't really engage the neighbors. That just keeps people up above the neighborhood as well. You know, we're sort of isolating this whole block from the neighborhood. I think you're going to alienate them. You've referenced the density of the development of 30 Haven, but you keep mixing in the commercial numbers in there, and so I don't think that's really a fair comparison. The DSG, the Downtown Smart Growth District, has a 45-foot height limit, and it also requires the top story to step back, which you're not doing, which I think would help break up the mass. I mean, I have a bunch more, but actually I have a technical question for you then. What's the fire rating between the podium and the upper level that allows you to make that a separate building?
So if the podium level is constructed as either steel or concrete, and if it's steel, it is fireproofed in accordance with the code. The rating that's required is, it has to match the rating of the occupancy at the podium level. And so that is a 2-hour separation. If this is done as concrete, it'll actually be a 3-hour separation. So it even exceeds the code by an hour in terms of its rating. But the 2-hour rating is achieved just as a function of the actual assembly itself. If it's steel, it's a thin concrete slab on top of a steel deck with fireproofing. when you go through and assemble that and compare it with the rating agency is known as the UL. They test these assemblies and determine their fire rating properties, and those results of that test are used to drive the decisions for the assemblies that are used to comply with code.
No, I understand how the how the rating is achieved. What I'm asking is, aren't you required to have a 3-hour rating between two buildings? In order for you to separate them as buildings as opposed to unseparated mixed use or separated mixed use, don't you have that 3-hour rating? I'm just trying to figure out how you're getting away with starting the height of the building at the podium level instead of just the ground.
No, it's a great question. So what you're pointing to is, you're pointing to a specific exception within the code that talks about the separation between the two buildings. And the exception allows you to do a 2-hour rated slab. In our case, even if we do the steel slab, the steel separation, the steel system, we can achieve the 3-hour separation between the two, just as a function of the construction type. The reason I speak to the 2-hour rating is because that's the minimum that we find is required by code as a result of this type 5A construction type, but we'll be providing a 3-hour separation just in the same way that we're providing 1 hour instead of half hour at our corridors because of the amount of drywall we have to put on them to provide the sound isolation between common spaces and tenant spaces.
Thanks. Okay. Is Mr. Safina that spoke?
Yes.
Yeah, if the board members could identify yourselves for the record, that would be great. Who else would like to make some comments? Staff? Yes, Barry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Barry Berman, member of the Board of Selectmen. I didn't have the opportunity to attend the first meeting, so this is really the first opportunity I've heard to have you present the project, although I did read in depth the project book that's been presented. I have a lot of concerns, too, probably similar to some of the things that the neighbors have talked about, but for me, one of the biggest concerns is going to be the parking. As you know, as you referenced it in your remarks, we've done a lot of work in trying to bring revival into the downtown. The Haven Street development, I think, is a model. And while I really welcome the fact that we're adding additional housing to this to this part of the neighborhood, it's going to help the ancillary businesses. It's going to create more customers. It's going to create more life. The fact that there's not enough parking that you have on your site to handle not only the people that are going to be living there, but also just visit people who are going to be visiting. I take the train, the commuter rail, from time to time, and I drive down and I have my commuter sticker, and I have a really hard time trying to find a place to park at 7:30 in the morning to get onto that commuter rail. So the fact that there's now going to be more cars competing for those few spots, I think is going to be problematic. And secondly, as you know, we've done a lot of work redesigning our downtown to create a sense of place, a sense of neighborhood. And there's a lot of new businesses that have come about. But if you can't find a place to park because your residents and your guests are now in spots which maybe our current residents are using, people are not going to try to go around the block 3 times to find a spot so they can go to the bakery. They're just going to go to Stone. So the whole fact of the matter that we're trying to bring life in here, if you can't find a place to park, we're actually doing more of a disservice to those, to some of those businesses. So, while I think you've been addressing sort of the box you've been presented, this is my development, your development site, I think you really have to look at the whole context of the neighborhood and how it fits in to some of the other uses and some of the folks who are already here. So I know you spent a lot of work, and I do like a lot of aspects of the building. But what I would encourage you to do is to work to try to find additional alternative parking, maybe negotiating with the town or some other kinds of things to really relieve the stresses on the parking situation. I have a lot of other comments too, sort of about the building, but that's my main concern, and I just wanted to address that. I'm sure a lot of folks here feel the same.
Thank you very much. Sorry about that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have a question of Gene or staff regarding the waiver request. That's in Section 9 of the presentation materials. Is it correct that the applicant has to go through and justify every one of these waivers, including the waiver on parking requirement, which by zoning bylaw is 1.5 spaces per unit, and the request is 1.06 spaces per unit? Do you folks pass an opinion on that? Does this have to be based on trends, known ratios at other developments? What's our criteria for adhering to this 1.5? I'd like to know the answer. That's a question to Gene.
I'm going to ask.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to pass the microphone to Town Council, Chris Keep, who is going to advise us generally of the legal requirements that go along with the way this project will be permitted, which is not under zoning. As a 40B project, it will bypass the local zoning bylaw, and that now is before the Zoning Board of Appeals. So the normal review process that we would do with the Community Planning and Development Commission for a project like this, like we did for 30 Haven Street, we would look at those kinds of things, and we would have a little bit of flexibility under the 40R regulations. But 40B is very specific, so I'm going to ask Town Council to give us the legalese on this.
All right.
Thank you, Gene. And for those of you who I don't know, I'm Chris Heap from Town Council's office. So I think the answer to your first question is yes. The applicant, the ZBA will be looking at each waiver request that's been presented separately and should evaluate each one separately on its own merits. I would expect in the ZBA, in the conduct of the ZBA's hearing, that the applicant would provide the best support it can in support of each waiver request. For parking, for example, I would imagine that they showed the ZBA similar developments that they think make the case for the reduced parking count compared to what the zoning bylaw would normally allow. I don't think we've seen that yet from the applicant, but I imagine that'll get aired in the ZBA's hearing. And once it does, the ZBA will have the benefit of peer reviewers who will review what the applicant submits and provide independent guidance to the ZBA as to whether or not they think the case has been made. So that's sort of the practical analysis.
Who are these peer reviewers?
The ZBA has not yet engaged them, but is in the process of arranging for their hiring. As part of the ZBA's public hearing, it has the ability to hire at the applicant's expense
experts.
Outside experts who will review what the applicant has submitted and provide comments, critique, and suggested revisions to the project to the ZBA. And then the ZBA will have the benefit of that expert advice when it's evaluating the applicant's materials.
Okay, great. Thank you.
So that's sort of the practical response to how the waiver requests get looked at. The legal response is that Gene's right. This isn't under a 40B. This isn't like a normal variance under normal zoning. The applicant can request waivers of all sorts of local regulations. The ZBA is tasked with looking at each separate waiver request and determining whether it should be granted or not. Ultimately, what its analysis will eventually come down to involves a couple things. One is whether denial of the waiver will render the project unbuildable as a matter of economics. So that's one thing that factors in. And eventually what it boils down to is whether or not the denial or grant of the waiver request whether granting the waiver request would violate a public health, safety, or other kind of local concern that rises to the level of overriding the need for affordable housing in town, which is presumed by statute.
You know what? I'm going to be the traffic cop for this mic. It's just easier. Other questions from the board? Yes.
Sure. John Weston. Both in the material that you had submitted to the state and in your introductory comments, you characterized this as a TOD, a transit-oriented development. And I think you've got it part right. It's near transit, and in the industry we call it transit adjacent development. We, as a town of Reading, would really like to think that we're transit oriented. We're not there yet. Part of the idea of transit oriented development is that you can live, work, and play in the same location. We can live here. We can work here. We can play here. But there are some big parts that make it difficult to live without a car in Reading. Someone at the ZBA mentioned that have a good time getting groceries from that site, walking down. You know, now that we don't have Atlantic anymore, walking down to Market Basket. And so I guess my concern is that that you have taken the credit for being a transit-oriented development in lowering your parking ratios, but you haven't done anything, you haven't shown anything that adds the reason for that part of life in a TOD that you don't need that car. You mentioned Zipcar. There are no Zipcars in Reading. So I know a lot of times some developments sponsor Zipcars as part of their development. When developments in places that really are TOD, like I'm going to throw Cambridge out there, developers need to provide support of why their transit mode share is going to be high, whether it's providing shuttles, providing Zipcar, providing not just the fact that the development is next to a transit station, but the rest of the way that we live and making sure that those people actually don't have second or third cars, but do use transit. So I think it's great if we can start in Reading to be more transit-oriented and have that transit-oriented development, but I think that you're taking the credit for calling it a TOD, but not giving, not adding in the components that would make it a true TOD and not just a development that happens to be next to a train station.
Thank you. Okay, other questions, comments from the board? Yes.
So I do have a couple of questions. Matter of fact, I have, as many of us do, many questions about this. We're kind of beating the parking thing to death, so I'm going to leave that one alone for, it's come up a number of times. I think it's an issue that needs to be addressed. But in a totally different light, I know that a certain portion of these apartments would be rented as affordable housing. Is that correct? And so a couple of questions come to mind around that. One, who's going to make that decision? Who's going to adjudicate who gets in there? And are you willing to turn that jurisdiction over to the town or to a town authority to consider who would be eligible to rent the affordable housing inside this facility?
Sure.
And then I got another one. I think. We'll see.
So a good question. Our 40B consultant, Jeff Angler from SEP Consultants, they handle a majority of the affordable housing lotteries across the state. So he'd probably have a much more eloquent answer. But it's got to be a company like that that is certified in the state to handle those lotteries, usually does it. We have had discussions about local preference given to the town. Mm-hmm. That maybe Jane could speak maybe in a little more detail, that we've begun those discussions on how that works, because there were some questions on some previous developments in town and local preference. So we're more than happy to make that part of the development, but the affordable housing component is state mandated and is usually run by a company like SEB that we hire. So Jeff will at another meeting, at the next zoning meeting, probably have a long-winded answer on that for you, and so I'll leave that to his realm. But we're more than happy to entertain local preference or any other ideas that the board may have.
Okay.
Okay.
And with regard to the identification of where they are, who makes that decision, effectively, the applicant goes through and decides, based on the percentage of affordable units that are required, how they should be distributed throughout the project. And the mass housing laws require those units to be evenly distributed by type and also by location on the project. And they also require that the affordable units be built to the same standard as the market rate units, so that you're not just building a lesser grade apartment.
Mm-hmm.
And then that is submitted as a plan to mass housing for review and approval. So it's all run back through the state agency and coordinated with mass housing.
So as a follow-up to that, then, if you're interested in, you know, local preference, that's good. That's important, I think. If we're enjoined from having local jurisdiction, and it sounds like you're thinking that's the case, but I guess we're going to need to hear that from somebody else, that, you know, we can't be the authority that makes those decisions. And is that the case? Have you ever considered, you've got a certain amount of affordable units. Those affordable units are going to deliver a certain rate of return. That rate of return is going to be substantially different from the rate of return that you'd receive on a market rate unit. Agree? Yeah. So maybe it would be in your best interest and in the town's best interest for you to consider making a payment to the town in lieu of the affordable housing, and let us make a decision as to what we want to do with that money ourselves in another location that might better serve the town. Are you open to that discussion?
It's under state law, I don't think that it's allowed. The 40D's process mandates that the units for that project have to be in that building. I'll confirm that. One of town zoning bylaws have those provisions in there, under different special permit processes where they do allow payment in lieu of actual units or providing units off-site. But under the state mandated 40B law, I don't think that is permitted. So
I think it's something that we need to explore.
I think a lot of developers would pursue that option, but the state doesn't allow that in this town.
Oh, thank you, ma'am.
Anything else on the boards? Kevin.
Thanks, Chairman. Kevin Sexton, Board of Selectmen. Just a couple of questions. I know you guys have heard a lot about the height of the building. That's certainly, I'm sure, going to be a big topic here tonight when we open up to public discussion. The parcel, as everyone knows, goes kind of around the corner business. That's Brown's Automotive on the corner there. I know you have spoken to the owner over there before and tried to require that. These plans that are set before us tonight, or that we're looking at, the proposal of the building, is it my understanding that this is not something that's set in stone as of yet? In other words, the permit is a long way away from saying these are the stamp plans and this is exactly what we're building. Or is that exactly what we're looking at?
This is a process. We're not, here to say this is what it is and this is what it's going to be. And, we're here. There's been some good comments tonight. Stepping the building, parking ratio is something we've discussed at length internally. We want it to work too. We don't want people won't move there if it doesn't work. There's also the part that it will self-regulate. People that know they could only have one car may only have one car. So it's a balancing act of, the actual reality in the neighborhood, and then also of who would be renting there to come to a ratio. But I imagine that will also be fluid and change, and we're continuing to look at alternative ideas for parking too, for visitor parking. And so there is lots of fluidity in the plans. The design is something we really like. The height's a big issue. We have a pitched roof. Most developers now are building a flat roof top. We could flatten the roof on the building, but it loses a lot of the architectural features without really any real benefit in that sense, because as you've seen from the shadow studies, the pitch of the roof isn't really impacting that. So we'll continue to look at comments that this board, that the public, that the neighbors that bring up as we go through the process, and we look forward to doing that. So, you know, with that said, we've explored other, you know, alternatives at the beginning of, you know, the corner piece, and at this point, the kind of footprint of the building is kind of where it is. We'll never say never, but at this point, we've gone down the path and spent considerable time and effort to get to this point. But we're open to hearing all suggestions and comments. So,
thank you.
Just have one.
One of the other questions in regards to that, and the reason I brought it up in the first place, is where was the number 77, sorry, the units, where did that derive from? I'm assuming, and maybe incorrectly so, if you did have that corner piece, that could the building be stepped down a level and still incorporate that 77 or close to thereof to make it economically feasible for you to do? You haven't designed it to that.
We can only deal with reality of what, you know, is the property we're working with, so we haven't designed anything to that.
Okay, so there's 77 units that you have currently under the project we saw now. Obviously, you've run some math to see how that's going to work out from the building material, what it's going to cost to put the building up. Is that something? Is this a building that you guys are planning on holding for a long period of time, or is it something that you're going to be turning over relatively shortly thereafter the build?
We intend on holding the building.
Okay. Thanks.
Board?
Good.
Okay.
Yes.
Tuttle.
Thank you. Dave Tuttle, CPDC. I'll just bring up again something that we breached or talked about briefly at the ZBA meeting, which is the traffic analysis of the proposed plan, which was not mentioned tonight, but was presented at the initial of the ZBA public hearing. And the traffic analysis that was presented, or has been presented so far, was specifically based on standard traffic generation, trip generation models, which is are appropriate for any number of housing developments, but we're not covering the specific downtown neighborhood that we're talking about. And the particular concern is you're very close to some of the worst intersections in the town, like Main Street and Washington Street, Haven and High Street, Lincoln and Woburn Street, and we will need to see real traffic analysis with appropriate data for that location before we can make any decisions about an impact on the neighborhood. It's much larger than the block immediately surrounding the property.
And I would add that a full assessment of the commuter traffic load in the morning is quite important when you're considering this. Anything further from the board, we can come back to you. If not, I would say we have about 20 minutes of public comment. What I would ask again of everyone, please stand, introduce yourself, give us your address, and state your point, and give the mic back to me. Please address me, the chair, with your comments. So who would like to speak? Yes. Ms. Carson.
Jackie Carson, representing Sanborn. I just want to make a comment. I know that you have your own 40B person, but we could be part of the town, could be part of this developing the selection plan of, you know, for that benefits town and Reading. And we could possibly be part of organizing and being part of the managing the affordable units there and not having to go out to the lottery and things like that. That has been done in different towns. So, and also to make a point that there is a possibility, I know we're in the 40B, but friendly 40Bs, there is a possibility of also the buyout of the units. so that we could do a better job and putting him in a different place or something like that. So there's a number of options that can happen under the 40B that could better fit the town's situation.
Thanks.
Yes.
Hi, Marianne Downing, 1300 Drive. Everything I'm hearing tonight seems to stem back to one thing that is fixable, and one of the principals on this development team has shown in the past, according to my research, that he can fix, and that's density. This unit, and correct me if I'm wrong, is at a density of this development is at 93 units per acre, which according to a 2009 study that was done by MAPC and the Citizens Housing and Planning Association, that is more than double any of the urban 40R developments on this list, which had an average of 50 units per acre. The suburban ones had an average of like 18 units per acre. The only thing this development is comparable to is the adaptive reuse of mill buildings in Haverhill and Lowell, which had densities of 100 units per acre and 135. So I've got to assume this is a negotiating point, and somewhere in those briefcases is a better design with a more realistic density that will still be economical for you. And I base this on looking up. Mr. Zucker was involved with a development down in Westwood called Four Seasons Village, which was only 7 to 8 units per acre, a senior housing development. He started off with, depending on the news article, anywhere from 72 to 80 units. And before he withdrew the proposal last spring, had negotiated down with the town to 24 in the face of a lot of opposition. So that shows you are a very reasonable developer, and I hope our zoning board thinks about those same kinds of conditions and that you come back with something that is not trying to break a density record in this state. Thank you.
I'm a resident in 30 Haven here in Reading. In the downtown area, we've actually done some research here within our community that there's a significant population of seniors who also choose to live in downtown area. And that will increase substantially over the next several years. So one of my questions is, with aging, oftentimes seniors age into a disability. What accessible features do you have for this particular property?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So, as new construction, we're required to comply with the Massachusetts Architectural Access Board requirements for full accessibility in the project. Because the project is more than 4 stories, we are required to provide an elevator, and any level that can be accessed by the elevator, which is all of them, must comply with the standards of those laws and requirements. And so the whole law itself is probably 7 pages, but specific to, I think, the main points that you're asking about, all of the site design around the project will be required to provide accessible pathways from the surrounding context to the points of entry into the building, specifically where the elevator is. Once you do get up into the corridors, which everything needs to be designed to accommodate turning radiuses and turning movements and access movements to doors and other fixtures within the project. There are 2 types of units that will be designed. One is known as adaptable and one is known as fully compliant. The fully compliant units, which I believe the percentage, if I'm not mistaken, is 5% of the project, will be designed to be fully accessible on day one. So things like cutaways to cabinets to allow for wheelchair access to sinks, specific heights on countertops, door clearances that allow you to access from front or from side. There are a number of other measures that are provided, but within all the other units, as a result of Massachusetts law, they're required to be able to be adapted if someone wanted to live in those units, so that There's no opportunity for someone to want to live in the building and not be able to live in the unit because it can't be adapted to accommodate their needs. So it's very cognizant of those needs and will be designed to all of those standards.
It will ensure an accessible route from the main doors through the building?
Absolutely.
Sure.
Nancy, Dr. Pearl Street. I just have one question. I've seen buildings that have the internal trash chutes, but I've also seen them, they have the recycled trash chute right next to it. Would you be amenable to adding that? And then the other question is just a clarification. You said these 70% are one bedroom. Is that one bedroom with a den or a traditional one bedroom?
Thank you. So, and to your first question about the trash chutes, we kind of joke a little bit about it at the office because the size of the trash chutes are really important. The standard size for a trash chute is 27 inches, but it's not big enough to fit a pizza box. So we've oversized the trash chutes to be 30 inches so that they're more functional. But we do provide two chutes side by side. One is dedicated for trash, and the other one is dedicated for commingled recyclables. And so there is a function and a feature of that entire assembly that is designated for the purpose of recycling and for the purposes of sustainability. So these guys will work with their manager to ensure that the process of removing and coordinating those recyclables are either done through a third party or in conjunction with the town, depending on how all of those services are set up. In relation to your second question, which I apologize, I can't remember because I was thinking about that. Yes, thank you. So they are traditional one-bedroom units, specifically one-bedroom with a closet and privacy from a common living space. And that common living space is accessed from a common a kitchen that opens onto that space to help that feel like it's a bigger space within the individual bedroom. So that's a strictly standard unit.
Thanks.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Greg Jones, 26A1 Street. I'm certainly not going to beat the dead horse with the parking, so I'll kind of let that be. But I certainly agree with Mr. Berman in the sense that there are some really significant issues. One thing that I haven't heard, and I apologize if this has been mentioned at previous meetings, I was trying to count them on the presentation. What are the actual numbers of parking spots that are being identified for the plans as constructed at the moment? I don't know if you have a, do you have a number?
Currently they're at 82 spaces.
82?
Yep, 82.
82, okay.
All right, so, okay, I appreciate that. I mean, I think the plans are operating under some assumptions that I don't necessarily agree with. I don't think that, I mean, while I appreciate the plans and they are aesthetically nice, I do agree with some other individuals that have made comments that I just don't think it fits the neighborhood. I agree with Mr. Weston that I really don't believe that Reading is truly there in terms of, you know, being a, you know, community, so to speak. And as much as I think kind of building out long term and trying to kind of create a community where we can bring in young folks to then have them rent and then buy homes within the community, build families long term, while I agree with that, I just don't think that the scope of this project and the reality of these folks using Uber and things of that nature in these neck of the woods is truly a reality. I really, in my opinion, it's really suited more for urban settings, and I don't consider Reading to be that. That's all I have to say. But I do appreciate the you guys coming here and giving us the plans. So.
Okay, we have about five more minutes. Yes, Ms. O'Neill.
Thank you, Mary Ellen O'Neill. There's some large, lovely shade trees behind, I think, Doucette's. What's the fate of those trees? So are those on your property?
Yeah, those are off the property.
What's that?
They are off the property.
They're off. I just want to make a comment. I agree. I mean, I think it's too dense. It looks like it's totally squeezed in, extremely urban, and with no green space around it, I think it suffers, will cause enablement, actually, to suffer.
Yes.
Nick Aiello, I have a home that the backyard abuts the proposed site.
And I agree with several comments just about the size and the scale and the density. And I'm not opposed to a development there, a project there. And I think actually the design is nice as a building, but I don't know that anything overcomes the sheer scale of it. 50 to 60 feet within a couple feet of my property line. If anybody could imagine that, if you're not abutting it, if you imagined it at your own house. You know, I know 40B allows for waivers of the local ordinances, but I don't, something about it just doesn't feel right. And just because you can do it doesn't mean you should do it. And just that scale is, it doesn't fit. The other thing that was mentioned in a prior meeting, but I didn't hear it tonight, is the drainage. And I know myself and many of my neighbors, we get water in our basements with heavy rain, not just the 100-year storms. So I don't know how this development's going to affect that.
I just wanted to address specifically, I think, hear your concerns, but specifically about the drainage, what's going to happen on this site, and you know, just as part of state code, what you're required to do when you build a new building is any new impervious area, which would be roof, asphalt, things like that, you have to recharge into the ground so that there's no more runoff off your property after construction than there was before construction. So what we're doing here in a case where there's actually, I don't believe there's any mitigation on the property at all for drainage right now. There are, and I'm going to be wrong on the count, but there are between 10 and 20 actual drainage chambers that are in the parking area. As we were looking at it, it actually sits under our courtyard area, and all of the roof runoff is going to run to that location and recharge into the ground, so it will not be going to your property and other properties that are in the neighborhood.
One of the other requirements that's important to note is the rate of recharge as well is regulated by the code. And so right now, as soon as the rain hits the ground and it runs right off the property onto your property or onto the other abutting properties, it's just subject to gravity at that point. But within the project itself, it'll be self-managed, as Ken was mentioning. And the idea of retention is that you take that rainwater, you capture it, and then you release it slowly back into the ground, so it has more time to percolate and to absorb back into the natural system rather than just flooding it and then impacting the surrounding property. So it's by function of even meeting code, it'll improve the existing conditions, and then it'll probably take that and actually go above and beyond for that next step as a result of the design.
Thank you. Time for a couple more. Yes.
Cadence Thomas's 21 Arlington Street. My home is in the images, like the Google Map version, the oversight images that you are using. And I want to thank the developer for including time before 3:30 in the light studies now. Now you showed us something like 10 in the 10 o'clock hour. Can you please show us 8 o'clock in the morning? I believe those shadows are going to hit my home, and I'd like to see that. In order to sort of be prepared for how this might affect me as I live within the site of your building. And I also want to say thank you for mentioning the idea of visitor parking. I see we're making some progress, that those words are coming out of your mouth, so I really appreciate that there's possibility for some or opportunity for you to address those needs as they really do affect the neighborhood and the people who are living there.
Okay, in the back.
Okay, thank you. This is the third meeting that I've been at, and Jean Thomas's 21 Arlington Street. And I've been at three meetings, and Arlington Street has been mentioned numerous times by a number of people. I haven't heard you mention Arlington Street. The cars, as they exit the garage, that is Arlington Street. This is a little one street, one block long street. that's already very overcrowded and does not have parking. We have no parking signs. It's not enough parking for the residents. We have not been notified of your meetings. Please, I asked in the first meeting to include Arlington Street people. We're the closest ones, we're at 21. And in that extended, now you are showing the projected shadow, we are within that. On the drawing, I saw trees. Now, there's no place to plant trees there right now, plus have a sidewalk. Are those trees on your property? Where are you imagining those trees in your elevations are going to be? I also want to know, when the cars are going in and out, what does it sound like? Is there a gate that goes up? Beep. You know, what are the sound effects, please? And what are the lights that go on and the bells that ring and everything?
Sure, so we haven't gotten to that level of development yet with the overall design. I know that we'll be working closely with, obviously, everyone here on the board. Development team will be working with other members that have not been included yet, including landscape architects and the civil engineer, to further vet and evaluate the aspects of the site plan and where we can find locations for things like trees, other planting, other screening measures. And we're also working closely with the board. The systems that will be included in the design of the parking and the access will be related to making sure that we maintain safety at those intersection crossing points, but also we're reducing or mitigating any sort of impacts on the users in those kind of areas. We're trying to find that balance.
Thanks.
I'd say we have time for two more questions. I would like to.
Okay.
Ms. Blodgett.
Virginia Blodge at 99 Prescott Street. Two comments. First of all, I think the water runoff from rain is one issue. I think the ability of the sewer system to absorb 77 units worth of showers, dishwashers, washing machines, etc., is an entirely different issue. Second of all, the aesthetics of the building. All you have shown visually is a piece. We still have not seen a picture of the entire unit other than from above, which is completely non-representative of how the building will look. I'd like to see it from Green Street and Haven Street, looking across the depot, so that you see from Certainly Wood, behind Brownies, and the whole building, because I don't think people have a sense yet of the size and the mass of that building from what you've shown. Thank you.
Hey, would like to be last. Takers? Yes. We're on a wire. Can you come up?
Hi, I'm Gina Snyder. I was just concerned that nobody brought up the statements about master planning and what the town's been doing and the fact that the town actually was and had a number of very public meetings with a lot of input about what could be done with that property and a very nice plan and some lot of aspirations for what could be done with that site. And I really wish the developer would talk with the town and really consider that vision was really more of what should go in there.
Okay. I'd like to thank everyone. I'm going to turn this over to Jean if she could just sort of wrap up what the next steps will be in the process. I want to thank the development team for some very comprehensive answers tonight. There you go.
Thank you. Nice work. So thank you all for coming, and first and foremost, if you could please make sure that you signed in so we have a record of who is here. We will go back and make sure that we have detailed notes of all the comments tonight. There are a number of additional steps, and this will be a long process, as we've indicated. The Zoning Board of Appeals will continue the public hearing on March 17th. Which hopefully is a date that everyone can remember. And I strongly encourage you to come to that meeting, encourage your neighbors to come and be part of the shaping of this project, because That is really what I think we ultimately hope to be able to do. And I, the comment that was made about negotiating down and negotiating something that will fit in this neighborhood is really what our goal is. And I think that through a series of conditions that we ultimately hope to get to, we can come up with a project that is the best project it can be. 40B is a challenging process. It is driven by state regulations. And to the point that was just made about all the work we did in master planning, we did do a ton of work. And it's all online. You can see the work that we've done. And we're going to continue to have conversation tonight about planning-driven density under the 40R program. And Reading is quite unique in that we have two 40R districts, and that is a higher density development district. And that was absolutely what we had in mind when we began that planning process a year and a half ago, is to think about this site as a 40R site. It is just outside of the 40R district where 30 Haven is. So there's lots more to go. We will be hiring peer review consultants. That process will hopefully be somewhat coinciding with when the next part of the public hearing is on March 17th. We have the review consultants queued up. We almost have that process finalized. And everyone has been asked to provide reports and to attend. So these outside experts will be with us when we meet again on March 17th. So that's where we are. I hope that clarifies next steps. And I want to thank everybody. Thank you.
Okay. At this point, I'm going to call a five-minute recess. When we resume, we will discuss the 40R districts for approximately 20 minutes or 30 minutes, and then we'll pick up the financial overview about 9:30. Thank you very much. 5 minutes.
like my husband always does, what are you talking about? So I'll try and talk in regular English. So the 40B process is the one where you don't have to go by any of the rules. And you basically can do what we just saw. And we saw how that looks. The 40R, and these are state laws, which is why we call them numbers. So under state law, Mass General Law, Chapter 40R, there is an allowance for a community to adopt an overlay district. And that means a designation above and beyond the way that the area is zoned right now. So it's sort of another option for how you can do zoning in an area. And we have two of those. One of them is at the Stoneham line, where Redding Woods is. That's the Gateway Smart Growth District. We're really not here to talk about that tonight, but I think it's interesting that we should get credit for having two. The one we wanted to talk about tonight is the Downtown Smart Growth District. And so that's the one where you can see in the map is the dark purple lines. And it's mostly existing commercial areas along Haven Street and other areas down onto High Street. And what that was, when I first got here in 2009, that was something that the CPDC spent a lot of time on. With my predecessor, and then it went to town meeting, and town meeting supported it, and so it became another way of doing dense development in the downtown. But the caveat is that in a 40R district, and we talked about 30 Haven Street, where the Atlantic used to be, the Planning Commission can really have a hand in shaping that development. So when it comes to things like parking and height and all those things, yes, they can request waivers, and it's a lot more generous in terms of what you can do, a lot more dense, but it's really evaluated in a very iterative process, just like we do with site plan review. And so I think that this gives the town a measure of control, a measure of expertise. Our board members are expert in all of these aspects of reviewing plans and projects, and I think ultimately it gets us to something that is more of what Reading can support. So the reason we wanted to talk about this tonight is because we feel like we've seen a couple of projects go forward with this zoning that have been very, very good projects. 30 Haven, the post office, we've been in discussions with the selected developer of the post office, and that is another project that's coming that's going to be, as in these early stages is being discussed, commercial on the first floor and residential up above. But it will have the parking, and that's going to have to be reviewed and approved by the Planning Commission. So that's another way that you can redevelop something that's going to fit the community. The third project is the MF Charles building. I'd like to say that they're taking advantage of that smart growth zoning, but truthfully, they're using the base zoning. But it's still a nice story to throw that third project in. So now when we have started this process a couple of years ago, where we hired Professor Barry Bluestone to come in and talk to us about economic development, and we took a look in the mirror and we said, how are we as a community queued up for economic development? What are our strengths and weaknesses? And what should we do and not do to be more attractive as a community? And so we got a bunch of things that we worked on. And one of them was to put together an economic development plan. And we just finished that in December. And in this economic development plan, one of the strong recommendations was expand your 40R district. You have a winner, so why not expand it? And this is where you're seeing on the map, 1A and 1B are the dotted lines of the areas that the Metropolitan Area Planning Council, through this very extensive planning process, suggested we could really look at expanding this district. So we thought it'd be worthwhile to present that tonight and have some discussion about it. and see where we might be able to go with an idea like this. And I'll turn it back to the chair.
Thank you. So the CPDC is essentially looking for some guidance from the selectmen about how they should proceed. They're the lead board on this, correct?
Yeah, I think, you know, we planners love to plan everything. And we'd have a field day with this. But that probably isn't the right way to go about doing it. So that's why we thought this really needs to have discussion with the Board of Selectmen, with the community, and really more thought than just us doing dash lines on a plan.
Okay. So we'll do this the same way. I'll entertain questions, comments, first from CPDC. If you could tell us even more specifically what you'd like from us. Did we lose a few people? Yeah, great. Thank you. I need to free that up for you. Halsey, what'd you do to us?
Hi, I'm Jeff Hanson, chairman of CPDC. So right now we're in the process of, we had a meeting yesterday to kind of prioritize or kick off the prioritization for the efforts that we're looking to tackle for November town meeting. And one of the efforts that was not originally on our radar, but now is the expansion of the 4ER. So we're putting together a subcommittee. I think, Dave, you're going to lead that subcommittee in reviewing the 4ER, kind of the proposal right now, the dotted line to expand it out a little bit. We started to get some really good feedback yesterday on, okay, well, maybe this new carve-out should not be kind of a blanket 4ER. Maybe there should be some specific regulations in there, because there are residential units in there, specifically on Green Street. So we're going to have to work through a lot of those nuances within that area, which kind of part of the term is mixed. But we definitely want your input. We realize that it's a critical item to economic stimulation within the town. Perhaps we want to get a member of the selectmen on a subcommittee. I don't know. That might be an idea, but we can talk through that a little bit. But I'm not sure of any of the discussions you guys have had about the expansion of the 4ER outside of maybe the economic development, but we definitely want you to know that we're taking it seriously. We hear the feedback, and we're hoping to be able to get it on the warrant for November. It's an aggressive schedule. September, the warrant closes, I think, but that's what we're looking to do.
Yep. Kevin, you want to do my cross?
Yeah.
John Weston. So we were talking yesterday about this and a little bit today. A little bit of history on how we got here, how we got that the existing district. When some of the members of the board were still on the board when that was created, and there was a discussion about whether the whole downtown smart growth district should be all of Business B. There was a lot of discussion about what that area should be, how extensive, what it would do, and where it ended up being the way it is, primarily because two reasons. One was that's as small as it could be. Given the state regulations, and that those were all existing commercial parcels. So that was easy for everyone to understand, and it wasn't going to be a transformative thing in a particular neighborhood. It would be redevelopment of existing commercial. We had talked about that little, you know, the parcel that we talked about earlier, that being 40R and 1A, and even over on the other side of Main Street, the 40R district being over there. And I guess from my perspective, what I think this board, the CPDC, it would be good before we start out and start crafting or deciding whether we're going to do this, is really to understand, yes, the economic plan recommended that we look at expanding this, but what is it we're really trying to do? What's the vision? Is it just about economic development? It's because the hope is that it will change the character of of this neighborhood eventually, or maybe it won't. It'll transform it some way. If it doesn't transform it, it's not doing a very good job, right? So I guess that's really what we need feedback from before we start off is, what is the goal? What would we as a community like to see happen in this area? And then we can see whether this is the right tool to do that.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think so many times in Reading's history, we have zoning that chases projects. Someone comes and says, I want to do this, and then we all like scurry like little mice and we create the zoning to accommodate the project. Reading Woods is a perfect example. How many town meetings did we spend changing the zoning for a commercial development, and then years later, that's not what we have. So what I'd like to do is have the projects chase the zoning. And so when we started this process with MAPC and tried to sort of create sort of the vision, I think you look at Haven Street, and that is just, I don't think anybody can argue that is not a tremendous addition to downtown. It sort of changed the whole scope of where downtown is and what you can do there. And the fact that you have people living downtown, it just helps create and support businesses that in the past, you know, couldn't get traction. And so my vision of it is to sort of see that wrapped around. Ideally, the project we just talked about a half an hour ago would have been perfect for that, but that's water under the bridge. But on the other side, I guess what we consider Zone 1A, I see my vision of that is to create an extension of what we already have there, where you have people living there, new businesses, new vibrancy. I'd love to, you know, we're not going to get the Atlantic back, but you know, maybe we can get a Trader Joe's, we can get something in there where people can actually live down there and not use a car. So, you know, my vision is to kind of have it be similar in scale and scope to what Haven Street is. And I think that if we are proactive, I mean, history shows us when we're proactive and we say, this is what we want, we can shape it. Where we're really not successful is when we try to play defense and try to beat back something that doesn't fit our vision. So if those lines need to be tweaked maybe a little bit, expanded, shortened, you know, just to sort of help create that vision, I think it sends the message out to the development community that A, we're serious about economic development, we're willing players, and we're just setting the stage for you to come in and work with us. So I'm excited about this because it's really, you know, we're gonna have a discussion 20 minutes from now about how we're gonna pay for the services that we need. And so economic development, while, you know, some people can envision putting a 20-story building in there, well, that's going to just maximize our revenue. That's not what we want. These parcels are going to get developed whether we want them or not. It's just a question of they're going to get developed in the way that our vision for them. And, you know, we're not going to grow our way out of economic problems, but we can certainly make it a little bit easier on the current taxpayers if we can create more growth. And in a way that's sustainable, in a way that fits in with what Reading is. So, you know, that's my vision of it. I'm sure, you know, other members on the board will have their input as well. But I think the important thing is to be out in front of it and just to say, this is kind of our vision. And believe me, the development community will come and say, okay. And we'll get it to be the way we want it to be, as opposed to having to bat back something that we don't really like.
I raised my hand.
Yeah, we got a comment.
We're all interested.
I'll let you.
Go ahead.
I want to echo exactly what Barry was talking about in regards to the vision of it. So, you know, it's ironic that we're sitting here talking about that 1B parcel being a 40R, and we're just talking about how that's not going to happen now. When you look at 1A, it's a lot more space over there for that not to happen in the future too. So I think expanding this in that range is a great idea, because it does set up for developers, this is what you can do to come in here, this is the way it's going to work, and it's going to work, you know, with us, not necessarily adversarial to the purposes or the goals that we have. Also, as part of the EDSAT that went through a couple years back too, one of the major identifiers was our demographic coming up, where our demographic going over, I think it was the next 10 or 20 years, the larger demographic is going to be seniors and 20-somethings, is that correct, Gene?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So again, looking at that parcel right there, where what they're looking for is close proximity to downtown areas, you know, shopping, transportation, it certainly would fit with that model as far as what we can expect coming into this town as well, too. So you know, I think it'd be a good expansion of that. The only question I had was, in regards, when you come down, I think is that Washington Street, where it hooks back onto Main Street right there, the little grouping of businesses, was that ever a consideration of bringing that into it as well, too? At the bottom of the screen there, I can come up here and point this out.
Oh, down here, right here?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Well,
I think that should be done.
What was
that? Down here.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, the gray crossing.
I'm usually the guy that blocks this
I'm Dave Tullett with the CPDC, and I was a member of the CPDC when we went through the...
I hear you, Dave.
Hold on. Went through the World Cafe exercise, mm-hmm. and we did the initial, both the Gateway Smart Growth and the Downtown Smart Growth District developments. The initial proposal for the Downtown Smart Growth was the entirety of Business B. We were considering... Mm-hmm. and. I don't know, looking at this map offhand, what that boundary would be, but I'm pretty sure that it included down to the Washington Street corner of the triangle there.
It's to the tracks.
And
it's not residential.
And
it's not residential. Those are business.
Yeah, it included down to where the Rite Aid is now. There has been a lot of change in what was possible then and what's possible now. When we did the initial smart growth, the Business B area, every residential use was non-conforming in that district. And there's a substantial number of houses within that district. In the years since then, we've changed the zoning. We made the non-conforming less onerous. We made it much more reasonable to continue the residential uses in that area. So it is, in effect, a mixed-use neighborhood. You know, it's a mixture of commercial and the residential. In the 30 Haven exercise, we got the benefit of some extraordinary construction opportunity along with a good plan. So it has worked very well. But I personally think it's time to go ahead and expand the 40R district, perhaps dramatically. Understanding, remembering that it is only an overlay. It doesn't mean that you run in the bulldozers and take down all the houses. It means that if somebody has an opportunity, has a vision, and can acquire the properties, it gives them another choice. And along with it comes a lot more control by the town, because we have a whole set of regulations called design guidelines that are not, it's not something that we can't regulate for single family homes or for individual commercial buildings, but it is something that we can negotiate with when they're working in with the smart growth alternatives. So it's, I don't want people to be afraid if they see them, you know, the lines move out quite a bit, because that's, at most it's an opportunity. Doesn't mean it will happen any time in the 5 or 10 or 15 years, but it means that it could if it were right at the time.
Thanks, Dave. Thank you. I think you kind of covered what I was going to say regarding the residential properties there. Bob, did you have some comments?
I have.
Oh, yeah. Well, you want to jump ahead?
Yeah, we'll let Bob.
So you're resuming. Okay.
So, you know, I think that many of us are of one mind about the idea of expanding this smart growth. And I think, Dave, you really caught the essence of it, and that is that it creates options and opportunities. Yeah. And I think that a couple of things are true. We have a very limited amount of space to do things with that can have a long-range effect on this town. And by expanding smart growth, we're expanding the opportunities for that to happen the correct way. If memory serves me, and, you know, I think two of you were involved in CPDC, and then ultimately the Board of Selectmen having hearings, I seem to recall that 1B was a suggested location for smart growth and was rejected. And as a result of that rejection, you saw what we got a little earlier tonight. Because we didn't control our own destiny, somebody else controlled it for us. And I think that that's an error we cannot make again. I think, you know, the idea of expanding this district, this overlay, is such a smart one in so many ways. I'm not sure that, in my opinion, we go quite far enough here. I do believe that there are other locations. So, for example, I've had a number of business people on Main Street from between Haven and Washington say to me, you know, it would be nice to be able to do something other than put a second story of offices. It would be nice to have the opportunity to not fight City Hall, but partner with City Hall to be able to develop a whole series of one-story buildings that kind of call for an expansion, in my opinion. So in my mind, when I look at this map, I think this is a great first step. I wish that 1B was something we could include in this, but let's, you know.
We could still.
Well, we could, but, you know, I think that's got to be a cautionary tale for
us. Never say never.
That little triangle down there, for example, that that sits along the tracks between, you know, Washington and Maine right there. I mean, those are all businesses that, again, are probably calling for inclusion, in my opinion. You know, it's interesting. I noticed that little nub up at the end of Haven, where Woburn and Haven, or Sanborn and Woburn come together. No, a little to your right. I mean, that's a commercial building.
Wow.
How come we don't have that in there? I mean, it's an underutilized commercial building. So I guess my suggestion to you is bigger, I mean, you know, a more expanded overlay is a more expanded group of opportunities for us. So I do think that Dave, I really enjoy what you had to say, because it is not something to be fearful of. I don't think it's really an opportunity waiting to happen. And it doesn't mean that people won't live there anymore. It doesn't, you know, what it probably means is we will not have somebody come to town to build something because they can, because they can make it fit into the
shoehorn.
You know, they can make it fit. And because we've made some bad decisions in years past, we've got a numerator and denominator problem with affordable housing. I mean, we have exposed ourselves in a way that we need to take steps to protect ourselves. So I applaud where you're headed. I would love to, you know, show up at the next public meeting and offer some expanded ideas. I don't mean turn the whole town into a 40R, but I do think there's some opportunity for expansion of the proposal that's up there. So, Bob, you want?
Thank you. I wanted to introduce the timing aspect, especially for the Board of Selectmen. Last night, CPDC outlined some priorities for November town meeting action. This is one of the possibilities. In order for them to hit a November town meeting deadline, if that's important, there's a lot of work to be done by, I'd say, the June timeframe. They're closing a warrant in September. That means, effectively, I'd say public hearings May and June. That sounds about right. So that's the reason for the meeting tonight,
yeah,
if there's an urgency. And just to take a step back from some of the EDSAT work and the MAPC work, in my mind, there's three places in town to develop, which will lead into our next segue of where's the money coming from. There's down behind the light department and public works. 40R is not appropriate for there. I think it's been loud and clear that we don't want residential down there. What's behind me is the fastest one, leading to the fastest possibility. It may not happen fast, but it's relatively easy to do. And then South Main Street is also an opportunity, but that's a much more complex issue because you need to start talking about things as the board has begun to talk about a roadway diet, changing Main Street to three lanes with a center turning lane, changing all kinds of access to buildings. So that's a very long discussion that is not going to happen right away. So that's the reason for the urgency, if you will. There's no reason it has to go to a November town meeting and come to any town meeting. But that's the time frame that we're looking at.
Thank you, Bob. Other comments from the board at this point? Okay, I'd say let's take about 5 to 10 minutes for public input if there's nothing else from the board. Any comments from the public? Miss O'Neill.
Mary Ellen O'Neill. I was at the CPDC meeting last night when they were talking about these priorities, and I don't understand all the ramifications of expanding this and what exactly this means, but I do want to express my concern that we early on, not waiting until a public hearing, but early on start to talk to the people that live on Gould Street and Ash Street and Green Street and Washington Street, Main Street, that will be affected by this, because we would be remiss to wait to the last minute to talk to them. This is, I mean, if someone were rezoning the area that I lived in and I was never notified of that till the very last minute, when really little would be changed at the end. That's the reality. I think we have to make every effort to reach out to them now and engage them and talk with people where we want to do this. I really encourage us to do that. Thank you.
Other hands. Yes, over here. Over to the right, Kevin.
Did you refer to the fact that possibly the project we talked about previously could be put back under this? It's impossible to revert. What about Browns, the unsold portion of that parcel? Is he, that can't be reclaimed? In the 40R? I'm going to make a terrible admission. I was one of those people who thought that it wasn't a good idea. Because it extended at that point along Lincoln, and it had a piece of the property that backed out onto Arlington Street. It went longer than that. Remember?
Yeah.
And we would have had, Arlington Street could have had a commercial property on it. So it's a done deal. There's no way to.
Well.
I mean, things can happen. I know.
Let's let Mr. Tuttle respond.
We can't really say that the 40B is a done deal, but whatever we do to the 40R district or the rest of the zoning isn't a defense. Basically, they could come in with a 40B and redevelop the depot if they could buy the property. I mean, there is no zoning per se that will defend against a properly crafted 40B proposal. Because we have a friendly one right now going in the building next to the St. Agnes Church, the former classroom building. That one it looked pretty good. We've seen some discussion. It's probably okay. But 40B is the state law that basically overrides other things. If we could talk them into using different set of zoning regulations in the 40R, they might abandon the 40B. But it would be only a voluntary condition. There is no easy way to do things. I still think it's proper to include that parcel in some of the adjoining property within the 40R district, because the 40B may not happen.
Or it might happen somewhere else in Yeah. Mr. Safina, yeah.
It's fine. I'll say a couple of things that might put you at ease.
Duck into the...
The Downtown Smart Grove District rules allow for sub-districts, right? So if we're really concerned about what's happening on Green and some of the smaller streets, and when we have discussions about this district, and I was the chair at the time, we didn't do Woburn Street because we were concerned about the historic nature of everything that's backing up in there. And when we looked at Lincoln Street, we knew that we would never allow commercial on the Arlington Street side. And so we can craft the rules to say things like that. So perhaps we want something smaller on Green Street's edge, and the building steps down to that. Maybe it's only residential stoops at that point, and all the commercial stuff is elsewhere. So this really does give us a lot of control. It's not one size fits all. It's not that disaster that the consultant showed people that time where they developed everything to five stories all the way down South Main Street. It's not that.
Okay, do you have your hand up here? Who else?
I'm sorry.
Okay, going once, going twice. Sold. All right. So did that bounce? Oops. Kevin.
Get him.
They lose our corn.
Yeah, that was helpful.
I trust you've gotten the input from the board that you're looking for, and you know, we would certainly look forward to continuing the dialogue. I want to thank all members of the public who participated tonight. Staff, great job, as always. So we will we'll take about 2 minutes, and then we'll reconvene for our financial overview. Thanks.
Can we adjourn?
Yeah.
We don't need to.
You want to? Yeah. You go ahead and adjourn. Okay. If you
that's
want.
That's mine.
Move to adjourn right now.
Second. I've dropped the camp.
All right.
All right. you.
He did. Left me to fend for myself.
Yeah, I'd like to call us back to order. Okay, we are now here to talk about the town of Reading financial overview. Thank you for staying on a little bit late for this. This is the first meeting of several that will be held to talk about the important issues regarding Reading's financial future. We're going to begin talking mostly about the process going forward tonight. We'll have two follow-up meetings. Bob will be going over this in a second. But note these down, March 8th and March 22nd will be follow-up meetings. So with that, Bob, you want to leave
it off? Yeah, do you want to pass me the microphone?
Certainly. It's standard.
Thank you. First, I'd ask if anyone came in late and not at the beginning. We are asking everyone to sign in up front, especially get an email address. We may have already heard from you, we may have that, but for those of you that didn't know that, please do that before you leave. As Dan mentioned, this is on the agenda for the next three Selectmen's meetings. I'm quite certain we'll go beyond that for tonight, and I'll get into the reasons shortly. The first important question, even before you decide whether or not you want to have an override, is the time frame. Because there's lots of considerations in building a timeline and setting up some of the details, which I'll get to. And I hope we can hammer that out tonight. The next question for the next couple of meetings, are the current funds well managed? We have financial forums 2 to 3 times a year and have done that for 10 years. A financial forum consists of the school committee, the Board of Selectmen, the library trustees, and the discussion of, and the finance committee leads it, a discussion of financial issues broadly for the town, not only right in front of us, but down the road. So because we've been doing this for so long, it's old hat. We know the answers to a lot of these questions, but it's really important that the public understands as well some of the answers. And the fact that I might say the current funds are well managed shouldn't really mean much to the public without approving it. Have expenses been scrutinized? I dare say once or twice. And have other revenue sources been exhausted? Well, tonight you saw, you know, yet another example of that. The town has very limited revenue sources, though. I keep saying to staff that we can only invent another product other than taxes. Another question to settle, and I think we know the answer. Is it a temporary need for funds that we're running up against, or is it a permanent need? Some of the communities that have gone for overrides, and I'm thinking of one in particular in recent months, have had both, but honestly, the bigger portion was a temporary need because of the last winter. If you remember, the snow and ice budgets across the Commonwealth were very poor. And for those communities that had low cash reserves, they needed to replenish those reserves because they may have spent $1 million more in snow and ice than they expected, as we did. We happen to have a good bank account, so we didn't need that. I don't believe Reading has a temporary problem. I think our problem is a permanent one. But that's, again, something we need to discuss in public with the community. And if it is a permanent need, as I think it is, and I think most do, did we make some mistakes along the way that we should learn from? And I'll tell you absolutely the answer to that is yes. When I was on the Finance Committee 18 years ago, for 8 years, one of the mistakes the town made at the time was building some elementary schools inside the tax levy. That crowded out capital spending for several years and hurt operating budgets for several years, although more so the capital. And that caused all kinds of problems down the road. But effectively, rather than doing the normal capital we would do, we focused that money on the school projects. And thus, our fleets fell into disrepair. We started having very high expense bills and so on and so forth. The answer is yes, there have been mistakes made, and I hope we've learned from them. A linchpin of this whole discussion is communication. That's a real big issue. There are some rules. I'll get some memos from town council. There are some state laws. There are some ethics laws and open meeting laws we all need to abide by. And when I say we, any volunteer that's on a board, any elected official, any staff, all fall under the same rules. We're all employees of the town. There's things we can do and there's things we can't do. We cannot use public resources to promote an override. So I can't make a copy of, you know, some flyer that says come vote for the override. using a public computer. And then I think it's important that we just lay out all those rules. A member of the general public that is not specifically on a board or committee can do anything they want. Free speech. And then the real question at the end of the day, after we've set it up, is there a need for an override? If the answer is yes, how much? And that's gonna take a lot of discussion. I've started playing around with a lot of numbers in the last week. It's not an easy problem to solve. One of the philosophical questions the board will have to wrestle with input from many others, is how long is the solution designed to cover? One of the communities that just brought a very well-organized override last fall that failed said right up front, we're only trying to solve the problem for 5 years. And the opponents cited that as a main reason why they didn't want to support it. Although the same people also said it was asking for too much. But the point is, the selectmen will have to gauge what's the temperature of the community. We haven't had an override in 12 to 13 years. What are we trying to solve? So before I go on to tonight's agenda, are there any questions on kind of these broad issues and the time frames? Can everyone see that, or should I make it a little larger? I see. Did it not get large enough?
You need a big brick bed.
Looks bigger on the laptop, just not back there. We have, in the next calendar year, or next 12 months, we have three opportunities to have an override question on a ballot within an election that exists, more or less. The first one is September 8th. Believe it or not, next September 8th on a Thursday, the first time in state's history, is a state primary. As I understand it, there's no contested races and no ballot questions, so I suspect the turnout may not be that high. And it's after the long weekend, which is why it's not Tuesday. So one of the things the selectmen need to decide is that one opportunity. And much like our March 1st election next week, that would mean there's two ballots. It's slightly confusing to have two ballots, but we've done it before, we'll do it again. And the question as to whether to combine elections or not is another one to wrestle with. There's a certain amount of financial savings. I don't think it's enough to cause inconvenience if it's not convenient. I think the bigger issue is convenience for the voter and not having too many elections. The next choice after a September 8th combination is sometime down here in October. And I would say the last reasonable date is October 25th. So September 8th to October 25th is one window. And I'll explain to you why I think that's a window after discussions with Dr. Doherty and myself. To show the community the need for an override is a very difficult thing from a management perspective, because we don't want to necessarily put positions out as being eliminated. From a morale standpoint, that's very difficult. If we can be general and say 10 positions, maybe that's okay. But to actually have to lay out the actual positions that would be eliminated while someone's in that position is not a good idea. And I'll give you one example that just happened. I laid out in the budget that I just sent to FinCom last week the elimination of one of the positions in engineering. The fellow's already gone. So the finance committee didn't even get a chance to agree with me or not. And town meeting didn't have the last word. The fellow just said, okay, I'll get another job. So as an employer, it's a dangerous thing to be laying off people in paper, if you will, in any sense. It's a very strong market for people finding jobs right now. So the window of September through October would allow us to not need to submit a formal budget that shows exactly which positions are eliminated. Yet, we'd have to walk the fine line of making sure the community has enough information to believe us and say there will be positions eliminated. That's a real tough balancing act to hit. Each of those, the dates of the window there would also allow, I'm presuming that the selectmen, should they call for an election in that period of time, would be doing it for FY18, so that the tax rate they would set next June I'm sorry, next November, next October, November would not be affected, but that's another discussion to have to, for the board to have. If that window is not attractive to the board, and I want to get come back to it, then the next one would be in the spring. We have a scheduled local election in the first week of April next year, a year from the spring. That would mean that a budget has already gone through the town's hands, the school committee's hands, come to the town manager, been sent to the finance committee, and been sent to town meeting. The finance committee would be done, but then the election would happen before town meeting. So that's another awkward situation in terms of timing. What do you put two budgets forward? Do you put one budget forward? How do you handle that? And I'll give you the example of the other community that just did the five-year override. And I wouldn't have suggested they do it this way, but they're usually good at what they do. They passed a budget, their town meeting passed a budget last spring based on the results of an override passing, with the idea that the selectmen would call for an override if they passed that budget, which they did. And if it failed, they would come back in November and make mid-year cuts, which they did. So they had additional staff on the payroll for 3 or 4 months into a fiscal year, and had to thus cut even more to make the budget balance. So that was a choice they made, and it only lost by, I think it was 300 or 400 votes. It was very close. So the timing is important when you think of how to operationally continue to run the town and the schools. And that's why the fall time frame is really ideal. But in order to hit this fall time frame, much like the discussion we just had on the November town meeting, there's a lot of advanced dates that are important. The selectmen will have to close a warrant for a special election by August 30th. That shouldn't be difficult. Formally notify the town clerk by August 4th, not difficult. One thing the selectmen will have to discuss is whether or not to call a special town meeting in advance of a special election. There's no requirement to do so. It's been a practice in Reading. It's generally considered good politics to do that, but it's not a requirement. And if a special town meeting is going to be held before August, then before August 30th, obviously it would have to be July or August. It could be June, but that's pretty soon.
Yeah.
If there's going to be a special town meeting in August or July, then there has to be a series of neighborhood meetings that we're planning right now, which we haven't. I've had informal discussions with folks in the school department, and we think ideally the best approach, first we talked about going to the 5 elementary schools, but we thought that might be a little too much. Have probably 2 meetings each at Parker and Coolidge. That's 4 meetings instead of 5. It centralizes the location. Generally, there's enough space here for the turnout you would expect. And having 2 meetings is good because there's always the inconvenience factor if you pick the date and someone can't make it, but they'd really like to come. So we think it's important that the selectmen, the school committee, and the library trustees appear at these neighborhood meetings and explain and answer questions. And this all presupposes that we have a message to deliver back to communication. The Finance Committee has met several times on this. I'll say the words that the FinCom role is unclear. They're advisory to town meeting, but they are also advisory to the community and financial issues. So we'll just kind of leave it there. But clearly they are not a policy board. They are not setting policy. They may be very helpful as they already have been in some other roles. If the later date into the fall is picked, it gives the selectmen a little bit more room to prepare. Neighborhood meetings could be a month or a month and a half later, and the special town meeting could potentially be in September, not in the summer. So that might be a little bit more attractive from a timing standpoint, both to prepare for it and to not have a special town meeting in August when there's a lot of people that aren't around. And again, for the additional cost of a local election in October, I wouldn't really care about that. So that's the outline of sort of the timing issue and why it's important. And in particular, why, at least for the superintendent and I, it's highly preferable that we take a run at this in the fall of any year rather than the spring of any year, just from a morale standpoint. Those of you that are familiar with the issue know that hiring for both the town and the schools is challenging and it is enough as it is right now.
Thank you. Yeah, I just want to add, thanks, Bob, for that comprehensive set of remarks. We also have some additional tools that many of you are familiar with that we're going to be looking at in conjunction with the timing, the amount, and other factors surrounding an override, and that has to do with tax classification. Many of you have been following this in the past. That is how the burden of taxation, not the overall levy amount, but how that levy amount is shifted between commercial and residential properties, and even within the residential class of properties. There are a couple of ways the board can choose to shift the burden so as to tax higher valued residential properties more than lower valued, or to tax commercial properties at a higher, different rate than residential. We started to look at this in great depth in December. By a 3-2 vote, we kept a factor of one, same tax rate for everybody. That could change in the future, the board votes again. My anticipation would be we would probably not want to do that as late as September. We would probably want to do this in advance of any such override so that people would know where we stood. While this effectively would affect FY17, not 18, the implication would be we would continue this the following year, too, in the actual year of the override. Again, we're talking a fiscal year out for this override. Let me be clear on that point. The FY17 budget is pretty much in the can at this point. It's going to town meeting in April. There will be some cuts and a little bit of pain this year. It's kind of the foreshadowing of what to see. Other comments from the board to this point? Thoughts?
Dan, you might mention the work.
Why don't you go ahead and come to that? If I might, then you might.
Yeah, thank you.
The selectmen have also asked me to work with the Board of Assessors on what other tools exist to protect, for instance, our senior citizens, or our lower income, or our lower asset value. And actually, I got an extensive memo today from the assessors describing some of the options. We can go as far as asking Beacon Hill, asking our legislative delegation to do a home rule petition. Some communities have done it, it's not common. But the board is really turning over every tool and making sure we evaluate all the options, because much as there might be people in the town and in the room that think an override's important, there's plenty of people in the town that can't afford it. Whether they like it or not, they can't.
Thank you. Barry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks, Bob, also for that rundown. I think the most important thing sort of right now to discuss the timing of it, my input would be to maybe do it later in the fall, as opposed to try to jam it into a special, combination with our state primary right after Labor Day. It just, people are gone in July and August, and I think this, two things. One is, we have to figure out what it is we're actually gonna be asking people to do. And, right now, there's, from the letters and the emails and everything that we got from a lot of the people sitting in here and folks outside, there's a lot of opinions and a lot of strong feelings about what we should be doing. We need to really look at what that's going to be, how much is it going to be, what are we going to be doing, and then just the whole education process of just going, having this be communicated in the community, whether it's a series of meetings at the schools or any kind of sort of private education. That's going to take a long time to do, and so if the latest that we can do it is the fall to affect an FY18, and if FY18 is going to be the date or the time where the pain is really going to start to be manifested, I think let's give ourselves the most amount of time that we can so we can be really thoughtful, include as many people as we can, and then be able to have the community weigh in, with the most information. So that's how I would be.
Yeah, I would concur with the, just on the surface of what I've been seeing here, the October option seems optimal. You're really too close to the summer. I know there are groups forming, advocates of the override. They're probably gonna wanna have a chance to talk to folks, and their attention, shall we say, is not at its peak in the August timeframe on issues like this. So that's certainly one consideration. I also want to make another comment. We're getting a lot of emails, contacts. We appreciate all that. Thank you. I know many of you are here tonight. There's another party to this, too, and that's the school committee. And they're going to many of the emails we've gotten are specifically in relation to not cutting school programs and that sort of thing. Our sister board needs to perhaps be urged to speak more publicly about their willingness to participate in this override discussion. Heretofore, I have not heard much public proclamation from the chair, the vice chair, or the board regarding their support. So I'm going to ask the town manager to forward every one of your emails to the school committee so they can also see them. And I would urge you to not hold back in your contact with them. You're the mic guy. Who else would like to speak?
Well, I'm just grabbing because I would. I actually want to echo Bob's comments in regards to the timing of it all. I think the October date is would be the date if you're going to ask this to put on the ballot. I think it's the perfect date. You know, just from a standpoint, humanity-wise, the last thing you ever want to do is pit one neighbor against another as far as your job's going to be cut unless you vote for this. I think it's really important that we do it before we get into that budget. It does complicate it a little bit, obviously, because you're asking for a little bit of trust from the public saying, no, you have to trust us, this really will happen. We just don't want to show it exactly how it will happen. Because it's just not fair to do, quite frankly. So I wanted to just echo those comments.
Who else on the board?
So a series of things come to mind. And a lot of things have been said from the board. One of the things that we have to be very aware of is that, as I've read now scores of emails from probably many of you in this room, there's some misconceptions that are coming through those emails. So however we allocate this big pile of tax money, it doesn't matter. It's a finite pile. Whether it's being paid commercially, whether there's an exclusion for, of the first $100,000, which would then force a larger payout from those who have more expensive homes. I mean, all of these things are tools that can be utilized to better protect those who need to be protected and have those people who are maybe in a better position to share the expense. However, you got to be very clear about the fact that none of those tools changes the size of the pie. It will not get bigger. It will just be reallocated. So that's very important for you to understand. And I think it begs another comment from somebody here on this board, and that is that it's our job to make a decision whether to put it on the ballot. Okay, that's effectively what's going on here. So the fact that you've responded to us, at a FinCom meeting, several of you said to me, both publicly and privately, what should you do if you felt strongly? And I said, tell us. And you have, and that's a really good thing. Because the encouragement to put this on the ballot comes from citizens. And it's been an overwhelming, encouragement by way of email and letter and phone call. I might add, I've received a number of those too, which I kind of welcome all of them. So we've got to process the decision to put it on the ballot. That's kind of the first thing. And I think that we'll get to that decision soon. Bob points out very succinctly that as, an elected board, what we should be doing is, number one, making a decision based on community groundswell as part of the decision-making process as to whether or not to put this on the ballot. The second thing that happens is that it's incumbent on us not to take sides, and we really can't take sides because there are many people that feel strongly that there should be an override because they think it's going to be very impactful either to the schools, to the towns, to the value of their property. And then there are others that look at it in a little different light. And so we represent all. It's very important for us There was a talk about us going to the neighborhoods, and the neighborhoods, it looks like, are going to be the two middle schools, which is probably a good idea to centralize those. It's probably also a good idea, I think, to have a couple of alternatives of choice as far as meeting dates are concerned. But what's incumbent on us, and frankly the school committee as well, is to assemble information and deliver it in a very succinct, clear, and transparent way. That's going to be, if that's where we go, that's going to be the goal. And that's what's got to happen. Because people need to make a choice. They need to understand the current state, and the current state going forward with an override at X, without an override, and what will the ramifications of that be. And then, you know, frankly, the citizens get to make the decision. And because it's America, people can form groups to, you know, forward one position or the other. And I think that the best way for that to happen is through a very solid, you know, educational process. I think a good decision will come once that happens, once we've really done a good job of laying this out, you know, without being a cheerleader for one side or the other. Because I think that my personal opinion is that that information will send people in the right direction. And you kind of have to leave that to them to make that decision. Because at the end of the day, when the override vote, should there be one, is over, we have to go forward with the results of that. You know, properly managing additional override funds so that it, you know, and I think that there's been exceptionally good management so far. We need to preserve and maintain that. Or if the decision's in the other direction, how to best, you know, maintain this community with a dramatic change in the way that the funding goes on. So I think it's important that your selectmen do the right thing from the standpoint of giving people the opportunity to make a choice and providing them with the information. I don't think it's a good idea for us to be cheerleaders one way or the other. I just think that that divides the community, and I think that's the worst thing that we could do to our friends and neighbors. I think we want to get on one page because it's the right thing to do. So that's just kind of my outlook on it.
Thanks, John. Other thoughts? I want to give folks here some opportunity to comment. Be my mic guy.
I'll be the mic.
All right. The people that want to speak tonight, raise your hands. Okay, we do have folks that want to speak. Mr. Burkhardt is first.
Thank you. Eric Burkhardt, Belmont Street. Just following up on Mr. Halsey's comments. So as I understand it, the decision to put it on the ballot rests with the Board of Selectmen.
Right, right.
And input from the public is important in making that decision. And you've heard it, and it's influenced that decision.
Yes.
Could you illuminate how the decision-making process will work as you decide how much it is and for what length and, you know, what you're trying to achieve and all that? And does input from the public influence that decision-making process in the same way that it influenced the decision to put it on? Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah, I think this board, Eric, has shown its willingness to certainly admit public comment at every step of the way. We might not have formal hearings. The board will do its thinking, its due diligence. Bob will, he's already looking at some very creative ideas, which are kind of in draft form right now. But we'll be sharing those in meetings, and the public will always be invited to weigh in, you know, suggest other ways, say we're on the wrong track, the right track. I welcome that. Okay, who else would like to speak? Must have answered all the questions.
No, we got one.
Okay.
Hey, Greg Jones, 26 Avon Street. This is just a real quick question. In terms of scheduling, you had the two time frames, one of which had the public hearings in May, June, and then the one for June and July. Is that flexible in terms of if you end up doing the kind of the late October timeframe, having the neighborhood meetings done in May or June? Or are you tied to specific time frames in terms of getting those things done? The only reason I say that is because, you know, June, July, a lot of people are going to be going on vacations and things like that. So I don't know if there's any flexibility in changing that
schedule. Absolutely, yeah. If we go October, I'd want to see that later, I think. Yeah. Maybe one then, one later.
Yeah. There's nobody in Reading in July. I mean, honestly, if you try to do this in the... I'm exaggerating, of course, but...
I'll be here. I'll
yeah, and I will be, too, because, you know, I never leave.
If there's any restaurant over there,
sure
they can...
Thank
you.
Somebody in the back, too. Okay, we'll get to you.
Jeff Barton, Thomas Street. Just to follow up on what Eric was saying, can you give a high-level overview? If the override is successful, then how is the process determined as to where the money goes? How does that process work itself out?
I'm going to take a shot.
That's your idea.
Thank you. I think that's one of the key questions that needs to be presented as information that, that all these gentlemen have alluded to the public. I don't think you just ask for money. I think you show how and why it's going to be spent. And that's a discussion that'll really take you know, a lot of wrestling with the school committee and the selectmen, and the six of them and only five of them. So if you know how that usually works. We have a very, I don't know, rigorous sounds a little inflexible, but we have a very predetermined way of deciding how money gets allocated in Reading. There's certain costs that are called accommodated costs, such as energy, fuel, out of district special ed, and those things are really priced out of our control. We have to pay for it, snow and ice, but we don't know how much it is. There's nothing we can really do to affect the efficiency of the cost of it. So we subtract those from revenues to begin with. And then what's left, we divide up, I'll say, pro rata between schools and town by our formula. Now, if the schools or the town have a new program or a reason why they want more money, so far they haven't wanted less, either one of them, then that's discussed at one of these financial forums. So for instance, a few years back, and believe me, there's a lot of staff meetings, the superintendent and myself met and talked about substance abuse prevention, both efforts in the Arcasa Police Department and schools. And the money for that was added to the budget early so that it was about half and half. Let's say 100,000 went to the schools, 100,000 went to the town, and then what was left was divided by that formula. If we had not done that, then the 100 and 100 wouldn't have worked out because the schools are bigger, they get more money. So my point is, there's a lot of discussion, there's a lot of collaboration. I joke about us arguing. We actually don't argue that much. People get along pretty well. But it'll be a discussion with the boards, with staff. What are the priorities? Undoubtedly, it'll outreach into the community. What are the community's priorities? But just understand, there's a very solid budget process in place. So it's not going to just be helter-skelter, you know, how does the money get spent? When Dan mentioned today, I'm looking at budgets out to 2030 and already figuring out ways of allocating money where I know it's needed for certain reasons. So there'll be plenty of advanced work done on this. And this is the type of discussion that's going to happen in the public, but you know, you have to put me into a bit of a cage so I don't discuss the full details because no one would come. It has to be sound bites that people are actually interested in. But not only is the amount important, it's how is that going to be spent very important. And that's the reason for the neighborhood meetings, are to discuss exactly things like that. Now, there's some question as to whether you have a first set of neighborhood meetings to have iterative discussion with the community, and then another follow-up with, this is what has been decided, I'll leave that to the board.
Ms. Carson.
the neighborhood meetings be at different times so that the elderly can be present? Thank you.
Is there a preferable time?
Not bedtime.
That's another relative time frame, though.
Well, can I see a hand in the back before? No. Yes.
Jeffrey Farm, Rich Road. I'm a little concerned about Mr. Halsey's comment that the Board of Selectmen does not feel like they should be a cheerleader for or against the override. My sense is that since you are a representative board, if you get a lot, 90%, 80%, I don't know, a lot of people saying we need an override because we think it's really important the town needs to spend more money to prevent this from happening, that I think if you get some overwhelming response from your constituents that you should, in fact, make a case that we as the selectmen have gotten so much information from the people we are representing that we, in fact, think we should tell you that an override is the best path forward for the town.
Kevin?
I can happily respond to that unless you want to.
Okay. Yeah. First of all, sir, I don't know if you know any folks on fixed incomes whose major expense is, if they're living in a paid-up home, their major expense, if they're living on a $21,000 Social Security allotment. I know at least a dozen people like that. Their taxes go up 10%. That's a $600 increase. So we have to be extremely mindful of that. We also have to be extremely mindful of, your opinion. The reality is, I think what John was saying is, as a board, we should not be cheerleaders. Under the law, as individuals, we're totally free to do whatever we want. Support it, oppose it. That may happen. I don't think any of us has taken a position yet on that. We have to go through all the mechanics of putting it together. Let's see what we feel the community can support. And then we'll make our own individual decisions. I'm not ruling that out. I don't think he was either, but as a board, we should not be cheerleading, I think is what he was saying. Did I get that right?
Yes, Dad. giving me this. I usually don't let my father do my talking for me, but I think that Dan does make a very good point. And make no mistake, the fact that we've heard an overwhelming amount of people who have said, please put the override on the ballot. That's something that we've heard, and I guess what I'm saying is that the inclination, at least my personal inclination, is that as we finish the process of this discussion tonight and over the next couple of weeks, this is going to end up on the ballot. Now, by its very nature, the fact that the board puts it on the ballot is an implication that this is something for serious consideration.
Right.
But I must tell you, I mean, personally, I can't speak for everybody here on the board, but I will reiterate the fact that as an elected member of the board, I need to represent everyone in the town. And I have heard personally from, interestingly, the people that have called me with great concern about if their taxes go up, how will that affect the quality of their life? Because the margins are that thin. And so, and I've had serious comments, and Dan talks about them. The old guys know the old people, so they do call us.
Watch that, Sonny.
You are old. So, don't misinterpret, the idea that, your elected officials need to maintain a posture of information and guidance, but I don't think that I think the last thing that you would want, at least when I was sitting there and not here, the last thing I wanted from the guy that was sitting here is a political agenda. I wanted him to look out for the neighbors, the neighborhood, the children, the seniors, kind of everybody. And so I think that's the process here. I mean, and, we're all going to draw our individual conclusions because when we walk into the ballot, into the ballot room, it's just us. We're not elected, and we get to vote the way we want to vote. and it doesn't mean we can't support a position, but when we sit up here, I think we are kind of inclined and need to be, you know, the neutral party that lays it all out in a very succinct way. And I think you can do that. And the facts will speak for themselves. And I think that many of the people in this room are quite alarmed because the facts as they see them indicate, you know, a shortage of money being spent on the things that are most important to them. So I think that the facts will find their way.
Thank you. Who else? Yes, right in front here.
Hi, I'm Michelle Sandy from Millennium Circle. So I'm just kind of sensing, and I just want to get some clarification, that the board feels that there is a way to thoughtfully and mindfully most possibly put forward a ballot question for an override, taking into consideration our aging population, our business population, and our school population. Am I sensing correctly?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, just to reiterate on that, I think that's exactly what we're looking to do.
It's a big balancing act.
Yeah, there are a lot of balls in the air, so to speak, in regards to looking at this. It's not just as simple as do we want to have X amount of money or not. Put into the system, how do you allocate it? How do you help someone who really can't afford, who thinks it's a good idea, really might not be able to afford it? And then how do you also look at some of these younger families that have come in, and they came in here for one specific reason, the school systems. And they're worried about that. So there are a lot of things that we have to take into account. Part of that is the meetings that we're going to be having to discuss that. And part of that is, you know, doing our due diligence as a board and making sure that we look at every aspect of this to make sure that we are, you know, if we're going to put this on, let's make sure that we do it correctly. Let's make sure we get plenty of involvement from the community so everybody understands and they can make the most informed decision possible.
Okay, a couple more. The hour is growing late, but Mr. Tuttle.
Hi, Dave Tuttle, CBDC and the town meeting representative for Precinct 3. Just a note of clarification that the budget is approved by town meeting.
Correct.
A different set of elected representatives.
Correct.
So the getting the override on the ballot is an important thing.
Yes.
Everybody gets to decide as individuals, and then where the money goes and so forth is get more involved.
Yes. Okay, a couple final questions before we wrap up tonight. Anybody hasn't spoken yet, speak now or wait till March 8th. Okay, only once, twice. Okay, I hope we've gotten this kicked off. We've answered most of your high-level questions. I thank everyone for coming tonight. Feel free to join us again on the 8th and the other day, the 23rd?
Yes.
Okay.
22nd,
sorry. All right. So I could take a moment of personal privilege. It's been an honor and a privilege to chair this board for the last year. Thanks for putting your confidence in me. We'll be reorganizing at our next meeting. I will not be a candidate to chair again. We have a tradition of rotating on the board, so just want to take a minute to do that before we adjourn tonight. Is there any,
Mr. Chair?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Is there any other business to come before the board this evening? If there is not, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move the Board of Selectmen to adjourn the meeting at 10:26.
Yeah. Is that seconded?
Second.
All in favor? We stand adjourned 4-0. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.
Thanks, everyone.